The Thursday night lights are shining on BB&T Field in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where tonight Wake Forest hopes to keep Clemson's Thursday night miseries alive. Tanner Price threw for 3,000 yards last year, but this year the offense decimated by injury. Sammy Watkins won't start for the Tigers tonight, late to a team meeting, but he will play. And so too will Clemson's go-to receiver, Nuke Hopkins, second in the nation in receiving yards per game. And Taj Boyd's the guy who makes it go.
Hey, Thursday night, only show in town. You gotta love it.
College Football Live, Hyundai Thursday night kickoff.
And that will be something, especially when you can't go to play in the Big Ten Championship or a bowl game as well. Sammy Watkins, of course, he's not going to start. Oh, but he'll make some catches this year.
Coach, every team right now is dealing with injuries, but you've got two at one position, specifically at corner right now. How does that change what you're doing in the secondary?
Well, you know, we can continue doing what we're doing. We still got Gary Peters and Xavier Brewer. They've played a lot. They'll start at corner. But we just don't have a lot of depth behind them. Cortez Davis is a freshman that has not played a lot this year. Dante Stewart's a walk-on. So those are guys that have been repping. But, you know, barring any disaster, you know, they'll just play a lot of snaps and be the biggest thing. So hopefully we can do a good job on offense and keep our defense off the field.
Speaking of your offense, they're going up against a pretty good secondary at Wake Forest. Maybe doesn't get enough credit. What do you need Taj Boyd to do when you prioritize what's most important for him?
Take care of the ball. You know, that's the number one thing. That's one of the main reasons that we're 6-1 is we lead this league in turnover margin. So just continue to make good decisions. Don't take sacks. This is a type of defense that you have to be a little patient with from time to time because of their style of play. So take the checkdowns, find the rush lanes, and just, you know, do a good job of taking care of it when you do run it. That's the number one thing he's got to do tonight is just get the ball to the playmakers, and it's okay to punt it. It's not a problem to punt the ball.
Not as much fun, though, Coach. Appreciate your time.
Okay, thank you.
Guys.
All right. We, of course, will see you at halftime. Right now it's time for Wake Forest and Clemson. Let's join Reese Davis.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
You send a message. Everything you do sends a message. How you play tonight is going to send a message. What is the standard?
Best!
What is the standard?
Best!
That's what we play to. Everybody got that? Let's go. Let's go.
Let's go.
Let's go. Let's go.
Let's go, baby. Come on, baby.
Welcome to ESPN College Football Primetime, served by Applebee's tonight in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. The Demon Deacons of Wake Forest hoping to continue Clemson's Thursday night miseries. Clemson just 1-9 on Thursday night during the ESPN Thursday night era. Demon Deacons trying to take a step closer toward bowl eligibility. Crowd, many of them dressed in black, though there is a sizable contingent of orange making the short trip here to Winston-Salem to see the Tigers tonight as they try to get their seventh win and take a step closer to perhaps defending their ACC championship. The Demon Deacon on the bike, leading his team out. Here are the standings in the ACC Atlantic Division, both teams in this division. Florida State with a 4-1 record, but NC State is the team that controls its destiny. Clemson hoping for a little help along the way and perhaps an opportunity to defend its ACC championship. Glad to have you with us here in Winston-Salem. Reese Davis, Jesse Palmer, and David Pollack. Samantha Steele joins us in just a little bit. Last year, Sammy Watkins for Clemson was everything. First team AP All-American, but this year, yet to have a touchdown catch. Is he close to a breakout?
No, he is, which is bad news for the rest of the ACC with how high-flying this offense already is. And with the emergence of DeAndre Hopkins, remember, suspended the first couple games, then has an injury. just now, I think, starting to get in shape. A big game against Virginia Tech, one of the most explosive and dynamic playmakers in the country. This offense didn't need help. Him coming back, getting full head of steam, it's a bad look for everybody else in the ACC.
Baby, even though Sammy Watkins has yet to have his breakout game, this offense is still on pace to score the most points in a single season in school history. And a big reason why is the play of quarterback Taj Boyd. Now, we've all known he's an excellent passer. He's very accurate, has very good arm strength. He's a guy that can throw the football both from the pocket and can get outside and throw it on the run. But I think he's added an extra element and dimension to this offense with his ability running the football. And he's been particularly efficient doing it on third down and in the red zone. It's an added weapon for defenses to have to worry about. Taj Boyd tonight going to have to make plays both throwing the football and running it as well.
There's a little bit less of Taj to move around. He sheds some weight, a more willing runner. He'll go against Tanner Price. Kickoff coming in the ACC right after this.
ESPN Football Primetime, brought to you by Residence Inn. It's not a room, it's a residence. TD Ameritrade and Wrangler. Nothing beats Wrangler comfort. Wrangler, real comfortable jeans.
You're watching the ACC on ESPN, Wake Forest and Clemson. Close to kick, here's what Jim Grove had to say to the Demon Deacons.
Individually, guys, every snap you take, I want people watching you play and say, gosh, that guy plays really hard. But more importantly, when this game's over, I want everybody that's seen this team play tonight to say, that's the hardest playing team I've ever seen. Go to work, guys, get your win. Let's go.
So Deacons trying to hand Clemson their second loss, and Wake Forest, Sam, will have another weapon at their disposal tonight.
Clemson may be favored on paper, but Wake Forest has their star wide receiver Michael Campanaro back in the lineup for the first time since the Duke game in September. Now, at the time of that injury, he was second in the FBS in receptions, still has the most receptions on the whole team, even though he missed the whole month. And tonight, some more good news for Wake fans. He's going up against two backup corners. Neither one of them traveled. I asked Dabo Sweeney about it. He said depth is going to be an issue at the cornerback position tonight.
Sam, it will indeed. Campanaro, with that broken hand, has been working catching tennis balls. And yesterday, as part of his therapy, stuck his hand in an ice tub. Anything to play on Thursday night. Clemson wins the toss. They'll receive. Jimmy Newman will kick it away. And deep for the Tigers is Sammy Watkins. And Watkins will watch it sail out of the back of the end zone. And Taj Boyd will start the night at quarterback. Boyd thrown for over 1,900 yards and 15 touchdowns already this season.
And Taj Boyd has been excellent. A perfect type fit for this offense that can really do some damage with his feet. He's proven he's gotten better with his arm. He's gotten better with the tempo. Really is tough to defend him as a defensive person because of his feet and his arm.
Now, Sammy Watkins, though he was deep to receive the kickoff, not starting. He was 3 minutes late to a team meeting this week. I guess kickoffs don't count as starting. He's not in the lineup now. We will see plenty of him. And Boyd's first pass is to Newt Hopkins. And Hopkins stays on his feet. He's second in the nation, averaging nearly 121 yards per game receiving. He will have a huge impact, along with Andre Ellington. And once Sammy makes his way onto the field, he'll impact as well.
You want speed? Well, there you go. You hold your breath every time Andre Ellington, DeAndre Hopkins, and Sammy Watkins touch the football, because they can take it to the house like that.
Ellington with his first carry of the night. And Andre Ellington across the 35, he'll have enough for the first down.
I think the greatest advantage Clemson has on offense tonight is their size on the offensive line. Per player, they average outweighing Wake Forest by 50 pounds a guy up front. That's got to show up tonight.
Half a hundred's pretty good.
That's a lot of weight.
That's a lot of weight.
That's what you've lost.
Oh, boy.
Boyd, with a blitz coming, fires it to Adam Humphries. Humphries with a short pickup, maybe three. And on the subject of that size advantage up front from Clemson, keep an eye on Wake Forest's Nikita Whitlock. He's number 50, most often will line up right over the center. He's a little guy, but he's disruptive. There is Whitlock, and Audrick McDowell has checked in. McDowell has a carry. And Sammy Watkins has also played. So I guess the punishment for being 3 minutes late is two plays.
And you just talked about Whitlock making a tackle on that last play. Guys, hurt his ankle earlier in the season against UNC, missed three games. He's little. They list him at 5'11". We saw him in person yesterday. He might not be 5'9", but he gets under those blockers, and you can see he's difficult to get your hands on.
My boy was born with leverage. It's one thing to play with leverage. He was born with it and lives with it.
See if Whitlock can help Wake get off the field on third down. We're in the flat to Ellington, and Ellington is stopped well short of the first down. Whitlock, who's a guy who the defense says he can cross gaps. He can rush and then get out to the perimeter to make plays as well. It'll be fourth down. Clemson is converting 52% of the time on third down, but Wake gets him off the field this time.
It's interesting too, Reese, because most nose tackles are big, huge, fat guys that all they do is try to eat up two blocks. He's a guy that kind of penetrates, moves around, and really causes havoc.
Lavelle Jackson signaling for everyone to get away from the punt. Clemson will down it at the 21, and that's where Tanner Price will take over for Wake Forest. And Tanner Price, this is a patchwork offensive system that the Demon Deacons will run tonight.
Tanner Price is an excellent thrower, but you might not get a chance to see that tonight because of the injuries on the offensive line and at wide receiver. They've become a run-oriented offense, and a lot of that is on Tanner Price. You're going to see him in the option. You're going to see him in the zone read. He may catch a pass tonight when Wake Forest lines up in the Wildcat. He's going to have to be extremely tough.
Sam mentioned Michael Campanaro is starting. He's at the top of the screen in the slot. Price is going to throw on first down. He's throwing a go route. He's got a man out there, but he threw it out of bounds. I'm not sure that it was Brandon Terry. Never saw that one coming. The impact players for the Demon Deacons tonight: Michael Campanaro, who was among the national leaders in receptions and yards per game before he was hurt. Josh Harris, the running back you've already heard from Whitlock tonight.
Yeah, and Josh Harris will be the guy that we'll see a lot from. I mean, really, their offensive bell cow, a guy they can give the football to, and probably their best player, especially because Cam's been banged up for a while.
Tries to throw again. Takes a shot as he turns it loose. He's looking for Terry again, so 0 for 2, throwing the football down the field. Spencer Shuey was applying.
I thought we were going to see a lot of runs, Jess.
Yeah, well, you heard Sam in the beginning talk about the injuries at cornerback for Clemson in this game, and Steve Lobotsky, the offensive coordinator for Wake Forest, not wasting any time, challenging them. Now, here's the critical down and distance. Third down, 1 for 15, and still somehow beat Virginia last week. They're going to have to do a better job running the football in this game to set up manageable third downs. They can't go 1 for 15 and expect to win tonight.
I was talking to Lobotsky about his longtime relationship with Jim Grove. He's worked for him since he got here. He said, although he might fire me if I go 1 for 15 on third down again. Pressure coming. Picked up nicely by Harris, and a dart complete to Terrence Davis, and it's a first down for the Demon Deacons, and so a third down conversion matching the number they had against
and
Virginia.
Tremendous pass protection. Davey, you were talking about the impact player Josh Harris, a running back. Check out the blitz pickup around the corner coming from the outside. This is textbook, putting his face in the fan right there, getting a defender on the ground. That allows Tanner Price clear window to throw the football.
And one thing to watch about this defense is Venables guys are still learning it. They do a lot. They do too much at times, and sometimes guys are in the wrong spot.
DeAndre Martin is going to take the snap. He threw a couple of passes last week against Virginia, and he throws one to Tanner Price immediately, and Price catch it, step out of bounds. Good pickup on first down.
That's not the first time this has happened. Now, guys, tonight, this is a survival mode offense because of the injury. So we're going to see some funky formations. You're going to see Wildcat. You're going to see the option. You're going to see the quarterback catching passes. Anything they can do to try and generate points against Clemson with so many injuries on the offensive line and at receiver.
Four different starting combinations on the offensive line. Number of guys they expected to be starters never made it past spring practice for various reasons. DeAndre Martin gets nothing. He might have lost a yard. The third down and about four.
And that right there is why you see that they have to do some of that stuff. When they line up and just pound the football, Wake Forest isn't very good at it yet. And you got to give them a lot of credit because of all the injuries. They've completely adjusted and changed it. But running situations, lineup, grown man football, they're going to struggle a little bit.
They tried to be that earlier. They tried to be an I formation team a few weeks ago, found out the offensive line not good enough. They tried to throw it 38 times against Maryland, found out O-line not good enough.
Somewhere in between?
So this is where they are.
Price had an opportunity to convert that third down. Was Aaron in his toss toward Brandon Terry. Travis Blanks on the coverage, and it'll be fourth down for the Demon Deacons. And we talked about the different combinations on the offensive line. Chance Raines left the team. They moved him to second team, trying to get ready to motivate him, and he motivated himself off the team. Dylan Hartzell, a career-ending back injury. Stephen Chase is playing. He's playing with a torn ACL and playing left tackle. A variety of issues for Steve Lobotsky's offense. Adam Humphries makes the fair catch, just a shade inside his own 15-yard line, and the Tigers will have it for the second time tonight. So each defense gets a stop early. Clemson and Wake Forest scoreless in the first quarter. And what a weekend it's going to be on ESPN and ABC. Ohio State, not in the BCS standings, but number 9 in the AP, taking on Penn State, 5:30 on ESPN. Showdown between unbeaten Notre Dame and Oklahoma. A pair of unbeatens in Tuscaloosa, Mississippi State, and number 1, Alabama. That's at 8:30 Eastern time on ESPN. Of course, you can see everything on the Watch ESPN app. Andre Ellington for Clemson slips and falls in the backfield, and Andre loses a yard. It'll be 2nd and 11. So as Mississippi State gets ready to make that hour and a half or so trip down Highway 82 to Tuscaloosa, you see the 8-0 We Believe signs all over Stark Vegas. Final practice, or full practice anyway, before Dan Mullen's team takes on Alabama. Boyd going out in flat, a short game. Brandon Ford has it. Ford, a graduate student, has his degree in sociology. Be third down for the Tigers.
Wake Forest's defense right now is doing an excellent job keeping the football in front of them. When a guy makes a play or makes a catch, they're doing a good job rallying the ball.
The Tigers need to get the ball to the 25. Boyd running out of time. Eludes a couple of Demon Deacons, but not a host of them. First guy to get in there. Joey Ehrman, his dad, played a little defensive line back in the day in the NFL.
Hey, they're not big, but they're hyperactive. You watch the defensive line, they all slant to the left. All of them not staying blocked. Everybody come, look at that, 4-5. All of them getting a little bit of a piece in there. If you're not big, you can overcompensate with some little bit of hustle.
Lavelle Jackson, again, a very short punt. Clemson, Spencer Benton, averaging a little over 39 yards from the punt. Didn't get a very good one off that time. Wake, we'll have it back.
ESPN College Football Primetime is served by Applebee's. Try the new Southwest Flavors 2 for $20 menu all season long. See you tomorrow. And in part by Hyundai. Go online and show your loyalty to your school at HyundaiShowYourLoyalty.com.
Make it to the championship game in intramurals, and you get to play on BB&T Field. Sigma Chi defeated up all night. That might be the worst fumble in the history of flag football. Sigma Chi won it 18-7. When you get some t-shirts, and they're pitching some t-shirts out in the crowd.
Sigma Chi represent. A bunch of teammates at Florida went to Sigma Chi.
Appreciate that insight.
You don't get that just anywhere, Reese Davis.
Josh Harris.
That's why I get the big bucks, ladies and gentlemen.
Were there other fraternity people that you knew in Florida,
we had
too?
Some ale pie. You know, I used to live just near Fraternity Row my first 2 years in Gainesville.
Sorry I asked.
Yeah. Got dangerous.
Sorry. Yeah. Sorry, you got plenty of experience with that, Jess. Let's talk about the game. Not your game, Jess. The game.
Yeah, on the field. On the
second
field.
And 7. See, that's what you do right there. You act like you don't hear it, then you say 2nd and 7. Tanner Price completed his third pass. Josh Harris out of the backfield. Harris in the backfield with DeAndre Martin. Is DeAndre with a carry inside the 40. Be about 2.5 short of the first down.
You know, I think one issue Clemson's had defensively this year, they're very inexperienced up front in the defensive line. They really miss Andre Branch from last season, Brandon Thompson, Rennie Moore. And a lot of guys that were freshmen last year having to start tonight. Brent Venables, a new defensive coordinator, playing a new scheme on defense. A lot of zone principles. He's got a lot of youth up front. At times, they've gotten pushed around in the run game.
Third down and 2. Third down is bedeviled the Demon Deacons. They'll try to run it. Harris trying to find some room, and he won't get the first down. It'll be fourth down now. You're inside 40. You going to go for it?
I am. If I'm Wake Forest right now, you're an underdog playing at home. A lot of the different formations. Yeah. Why not?
Yeah, I mean, you saw three running backs in a row right there. I tell you why I'd punt it, because so far my defense looks pretty solid. If they were driving and getting first downs and making me look silly already and had a chance to impose that tempo on me, right now everything's going in my favor. Maybe try to back it in and keep them deep.
Keep in mind, too, Clemson stuffed Virginia Tech last week on two big fourth downs in that game.
Well, and this isn't your strength. You don't line up and do the short yardage thing. That's not what you're best at. So no problem punting.
Freshman Australian punter, Alex Kennell. And it's going to be a touchback. Ball across the plane. So, as often is the case when you make those go forward or punt decisions, it's how well the punt is executed. Wake Forest picks up a grand total of 19 yards on that exchange, and Clemson will have it on the 20. Weekend menu brought to you by Applebee's Cincinnati. You don't just walk into the Glass Bowl and beat Toledo, and the Bearcats didn't, so now they'll try to knock Louisville from the ranks of the unbeaten. SC better be careful. As Rich Rod's high-powered offense, you know the two marquee games we talk about on ABC and ESPN Saturday night.
Can't wait to watch Teddy Bridgewater tomorrow night. You want to talk about a guy that's accurate? You watch him throw it. The football does not touch the ground. And he throws with a glove.
Give on the inside. DJ Howard getting a carry for Clemson. It'll be second and long.
That size advantage we talked about for Clemson up front, that's not showing up right now. A much smaller Wake Forest front seven, they're playing more physical.
There's only one thing that stops this offense from being the best in the country, and it's the boys up front that have had some inexperience. Otherwise, this offense would be unstoppable.
See, Clemson, as Jesse mentioned, with a significant weight advantage up front, Taj Boyd going to fire it into a hole in the coverage. It'll be a little bit short of the first down. The new Hopkins making another catch. We check in with Samantha Steele.
Yeah, Reese, I talked to offensive coordinator Chad Morris right before the game, and he echoed what you guys were saying right now. He said offensive line is where they need the most improvement, specifically at right guard or right tackle and left guard. He said the problem is we don't have enough consistency or depth. There's just not the guys behind them to challenge them, to push them to play harder.
And Sam, once again, Boyd's having to get chased, and Taj, very heads-up play, stretching the football out and getting enough for the first down. Nikita Whitlock was after him, but Clemson will pick up the first down. A good play by Boyd, and it exemplifies the lighter weight and a better runner.
Yeah, you know, and so many of his big runs this year have come on third down. He wants the football in his hand. He's told offensive coordinator Chad Morris, third and short, put it in my hand, let me go get it. He shows you why. Tremendous effort.
Back to the ground with Ellington, who's hunting and picking his way, but not finding much there.
He's kind of the forgotten guy in the offense because there is so much attention paid to everybody else, but he's the guy, man. He's lethal. He can take a two-yard run, make it go 60 in a heartbeat, real good speed, hugs his offensive lineman really well, gets more than blocked a lot of times.
Second in the ACC in rushing, a shade under 100 yards per game, had nearly 1,200 a year ago. Pressure coming from the secondary, picked up beautifully by Clemson, and Watkins is by himself, and Sammy Watkins very nearly had his first touchdown catch of the year, but it's the Tigers threatening as they get it down to the 10.
Running backs not having a lot of success running the football tonight, but they've both been unbelievable in pass per. Watch Andre Ellington here pick up the blitz from the outside, giving Taj Boyd a chance on the double move to find Nuke Hopkins deep downfield, or Sammy Watkins, sorry,
dreads.
Deep downfield.
The dreads look the same. I'll give you a break
single
on that.
Single digits and dreads.
Watkins picks up 57. And Taj gives it off on the ground. Not much there for Roderick McDowell. It'll be second down and goal.
Now you just get the feeling Sammy Watkins was just ready to burst out. And it's nothing he's done wrong. He's only played in 3.5 games, but you put on the film, he's a shoestring tackle away on a couple reverses, a couple slant throws he's had in his last two games of going the distance.
Had 8 catches for 84 yards in their last game against Virginia Tech. It was statistically his best performance of the season. And it was a false start on the Tigers.
False start, number 63 offense, 5 yards, second down.
Both these teams have been very good at avoiding penalties. Wake Forest in the top 10 in the country, Clemson in the top 25. a costly one there, but I guess you could look at it. This gives Boyd and those wide receivers a little more room to work with, and four wide receivers out. Now Ellington goes out into the slot, so it's empty with Boyd in the backfield. The quarterback draw. Boyd gets inside the 10. Nikita Whitlock, just before the snap, was actually looking back behind him at the linebackers to make sure everybody was set, and then he sort of vacated the middle, and Taj picked up a few yards.
And that's what makes this offense even harder, too, is when you do have a quarterback that's he's basically a running back. And now I got a double-team wide receivers on the outside. You got Ellington in the slot, who's a great receiver as well. You make me spend so much time looking at them, and he's a guy that can absolutely kill you up the middle.
Watch for Jerron Brown here in the slot, bottom of the screen.
The flip out to Ford. Ford has a chance to go in, and Brandon Ford puts Clemson on the board first.
There is so much eye candy in Chad Morris's offense. You got play action fakes. You got guys going in motion, faking reverses. It's so hard to keep your eye focused on where the football exactly is. Let's take a look here at Brandon Ford. See if he was able to stay in bounds before he launched
down.
Oh, that's six. Wow. And that just shows you how explosive this offense is. You know, you get a couple three and outs early, long pass to Watkins, boom, in the end zone.
Eight play, 80-yard drive, and the extra point wasn't the prettiest thing you'll ever see, but it went through, and 18th-ranked Tigers still hoping to have an at-large spot in the BCS at worst, getting off to a good start on the road against Wake Forest. Clemson has took a 7-0 lead. Taj Boyd hit his tight end Brandon Ford. 16th touchdown pass of the year for Clemson's all-time leader.
Yeah, and watch Sammy Watkins come in motion. You see the cornerback right here comes in motion to take go across the formation. But Sammy actually blocks the vision of the safety and leaves the guy wide open in the flats. That's what Sammy Watkins can do for you. Not just catching the ball. Everybody's going to keep an eye on number two.
Watkins with a 57-yard catch. The big play in that 80-yard drive. Kickoff drives Chibikem Okoro into the end zone, and Wake Forest will take it on the 25 after we check in with our buddy John Saunders.
Well, Reese, thanks a lot. It's time for the Sports Center right now, brought to you by Coors Light. Tyrann Mathieu of LSU, one of four former football players arrested on marijuana-related charges in Baton Rouge today. Also arrested, Jordan Jefferson, who was the starting quarterback in the championship game last year, and two former cornerbacks.
What a disappointing piece of news for both of those guys, but especially for Tyrann Mathieu. He'd spent time in a rehabilitation clinic. And John Lucas after being dismissed, and Wake Forest fumbled the football, and Martin ill-advisedly tried to pick it up, and it looks as if Clemson might have jumped on top of it. Jonathan Willard, who's playing with a bad elbow, number 46, is down on the bottom of that pile. Jerry Magalanes and his crew still trying to sort everything out.
Look at the umpire trying to get 26 off, tapping him on the head.
Oh, and Wake Forest very fortunate to come out of there with it. And it was Martin who fumbled it. He needs to fall on that thing in the backfield.
Yeah, he really does. You know, Wake Forest's margin for error on offense tonight is very, very slim. There's just an exchange issue there between the quarterback and the running back. But because of all the injuries they've had, guys, they can't afford to have penalties, and they can't afford to turn the football over, especially when you consider the juggernaut on offense lining up on the sideline across.
And the reason that's so bad is it's college football. If he picks that up when he's on one knee, he's down anyways. Don't turn a bad play into a catastrophe. Fall on the football. You have it.
Loss of five is best-case scenario for Wake Forest. At least they didn't give the football up to Clemson. Corner blitz coming. Tanner Price in the middle. And right down the middle, it's Mike Campanaro. Campanaro coming back from a broken hand, and the Demon Deacons get out of trouble with a 27-yard pickup.
Having Campanaro back is a huge boost for this Wake Forest offense, because this is really a one-man passing show. Campanaro, Sam had mentioned, was second in the country when he broke his hand against Duke. Does a great job finding the soft spots in zones. Knows how to get open, and that's a comfort factor and a level for his quarterback, Tanner Price.
A lot of times you just can't coach a guy like that. I mean, he feels the soft spot, sits down, just doesn't have to be a blazer. He's just got it, whatever it is.
Rice, the lefty, firing. Campanaro was out there again and arriving a little bit early was Gary Peters, who's making his second start at cornerback. Clemson depleted back there, and Venables corner will be called for interference.
Pass interference, number 26 defense. That's a spot foul. Automatic first down.
Wake Forest testing out these young, inexperienced corners. See Campanaro running the comeback route. Yeah, and Gary Peters gets there a little bit early. There's body contact. That's an easy call. They're going to test them until Clemson proves they can stop it. And that's scary because Wake Forest really only has one guy that can throw to.
Yeah, and the thing is, he could probably make that interception if he's paying attention to the football, but you get so caught up sometimes in the receiver as opposed to playing the football.
Wake back to the ground. Option look. That was almost intercepted on the pitch, and it is a big loss for Wake Forest. Xavier Brewer, he almost had a pick six on the option pitch.
Xavier Brewer starting at cornerback because their starter, Darius Robinson, hurt his ankle last week, lost for the season. So here you go. You're going to test these inexperienced cornerbacks. Well, in run support, being aggressive, beating a block by the fullback, Tommy Bohannon. Great play by Xavier Brewer.
And I know Wake Forest is trying to be creative, but this isn't what they do. This isn't who they are usually. They're trying to find ways to hide up the banged-up offensive line. And so a lot of times when you do implement new things, you're going to struggle with it. It's hard to simulate game situations like this. They've been doing it in practice and dialing them up in the dirt, but sometimes it's a struggle in the game.
And dialing up a little something new. Five receivers with DeAndre Martin taking the snap, and the flags fly, and it took them too long to figure it out.
Delay a game on the offense. 5 yards, second down.
And see, this is the problem. If you're Wake Forest, you have to be able to sustain drives to give your defense a rest. That tempo on offense for Clemson is going to tire Nikita Whitlock and these guys out very soon. If you can't keep drives alive, these negative plays do not help that cause.
Wonder what Lobo's got in the bag for second and 35. DeAndre Martin picks up a few, so now Wake Forest will just have to get into Mount Airy for the first down.
Yeah, it's third in California right about now. Not a lot of play calls in Sean Payton's playbook for this type of deal. And again, not built to throw the football with a beat-up offensive line. They can't afford to hold on to it very long here. Clemson's going to pin their ears back.
Wake Forest is going to run it and try to avoid further mishap on this drive, and they'll be happy to punt it away.
The only reason I don't agree with that, because I really feel like there's a lot of plays to be made in the secondary. You got two backup cornerbacks that aren't used to starting in the lineup. I mean, I feel like you got to give yourself a chance and try to make some big plays. Clemson's been vulnerable in the passing game to the big plays. It's kind of tough to just forfeit. I know it's a long situation, but still try to pick up 20.
There's the punt. Goes away. I'd offer the Humphreys signals for the fair catch, and then that hit off a Wake Forest player, it appeared to me, so it's not going to be a muff. Wake's wanting it, and Clemson's going to have it. I think the flip side to it, David, was they played conservatively, consistently. They punt from inside the 40, punt it into the end zone, only pick up 19 yards on the touchback, and here they decide to run it.
Will be first down to the spot.
It's just tough with the other that offense you're playing against. I mean, you got to find ways to.
I mean, part of the problem is they can't protect. I mean, would that impact it in your mind?
Yeah, no doubt about it. Although I will say tonight, so far, the protection hasn't been really that bad. It's not like the floodgates are opening. They may find more and more confidence, I think, as this game goes on, because Clemson really is not dominant up front in the D-line. They haven't done a great job all year with pressure.
Sam Cooper coming across the formation. Boyd is yet to throw an incomplete pass tonight. Hit all seven of them. Now he's hit eight in a row. Sammy Watkins making the catch. Chibi Kamakoro, who used to be known by his middle name of Kenny.
Okay, Kenny it is. Kenny it is for me the rest of the night.
How about Okoro?
We're just number six for you.
That's good.
Half minute to play in the first half. Second and five for the Tigers. They're up 7-0. Ellington. Andre Ellington rumbles ahead for the first down. Clemson likes to play at a quick tempo and see if they play quickly enough to get another snap off before the end of the half. Clock stopping momentarily to move the chains, so it'll be no problem for Boyd to snap another one. I think I said the end of the half. I meant end of quarter. Boyd going to take a shot. He's got Watkins out there again, and just out of Sammy's reach. Kevin Johnson was on the coverage for the Demon Deacs.
And I tell you what, Sammy Watkins can run by a lot of people. He can run by just about anybody. I think he eased up just a little bit, but Taj Boyd does such a great job of dropping it in the bucket so many times, just out of the reach of Sammy. Mr. Sammy Watkins.
And you're seeing his versatility. I mean, we've seen him on reverses. You're going to see him in the run game tonight, going deep, underneath, all over the field.
Trying to set up a screen. He just throws it away to Ellington, and that'll be the final play of the first quarter. Mike Olson was applying the pressure. So it'll be a third down facing the Tigers as they open the second quarter. Big play to Sammy Watkins. Set up a touchdown pass from Taj Boyd to Brandon Ford. Watkins has made his presence felt. Wake Forest has had some mishaps, and the Tigers have a 7-0 lead after one. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, served by Applebee's. Starting up the second quarter, Clemson on the road at Wake Forest. Tigers up 7-0 and looking at a 3rd and 10 from their own 39-yard line.
The Clemson's offensive line expects some movement, stunts, and twists up front.
Boyd firing downfield, and Sammy Watkins has it. Sammy on his way. Watkins inside the 10, and there is his first touchdown catch of the year. 61 yards.
You know what Sammy just said? Newt Hopkins? Y'all keep talking about Newt. Let me show you a little Sammy.
I think he just said,
woo!
I'm back.
He's back.
Well, Watkins, who missed the first two games this season with suspension, missed another one with a severe abdominal virus that caused him to lose about 10 pounds. Clemson staff felt like he was rounding into form with his performance against Virginia Tech last week, and I would say 3 catches, 123 yards, and his first touchdown of the season would be rounding into
form.
Well,
it started off with great protection up front by the offensive line, an excellent route on the comeback by Sammy Watkins, very poor tackling by Wake Forest, and then you see the speed and the game-breaking ability once he's able to escape.
Yeah, look at the protection. Great. And he comes back to the ball right here. Watch. Watch him come back or else the corner has a play. But look at him stick his foot in the ground. Zerk, zerk. Bye-bye. Tail lights.
Hey, you know, while we're praising everybody else, first, Boyd threw that ball right on time. That was sweet. But how about Jerron Brown, the discipline not to hit a guy in the back?
Yeah.
So easy in that situation. And Brown maintained his discipline and have Watkins go in. 17th touchdown pass of the year for Boyd.
And when you have protection with those two guys on the outside, I don't care what cornerback you want to put on the field, they're going to beat them. They're going to make explosive plays. And Sammy said, y'all keep questioning me.
Well, Taj Boyd certainly is not questioning him either, because he's been looking for number two early and often so far in this game. And it's hard to blame him. It really is. That type of athleticism, wow.
As Clemson gets ready to kick off, this is going to be a very important drive for Wake Forest. They don't score a lot of points, only averaging about 22 per game. Can't afford to fall behind much more. Josh Harris has the kickoff return. And Harris going to fall down just inside his own 15. Let's go back to the studio now and John Saunders.
Well, Reese, it's time for the Dr. Pepper Conference update. Friday night, 8 Eastern on ESPN. Two of the top teams in the Big East meet on number 16 Louisville hosting Cincinnati. Louisville trying for its first 8-0 start since 2006. The Bearcats have won the last 4 meetings in this series. Reese.
John, that 2006 team from Louisville went to the Orange Bowl and beat the ACC champion Wake Forest Demon Deacons. Won the conference title for the first time in over 4 decades under Jim Grobe. Harris has to carry.
You know, we talked about this survival mode offense. It's interesting, you know, when they got all the injuries, the offensive coaching staff walked into the defensive meeting room and says, hey guys, what do you not like preparing for as a defensive staff? And they told them, we don't like the wildcat, we don't like quarterbacks running it out of the gun, we don't like you mixing up the tempo on us, and we don't like trick plays. So boom, here's your Wake Forest offense. That's how that genesis started.
Steve was saying that one of the tenets that Grove always believes in, if you're not winning enough, change it.
Yeah.
Don't keep doing the same thing. the injuries and the suspensions they've had this year necessitate a lot of the change. That's a tough throw for Price. He's a left-hander rolling right, but he's gonna benefit from a roughing the passer call. Uh-huh. I think Spencer Shuey hit Price after he threw it away.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Number 33 of the defense, 15-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
That's such a bad play. I mean, you're doing such a good job. Your offense is moving. Dabo ain't happy. Look at him. Rolling to his right. You see him. I mean, the ball's gone. That's a good call. It's a bad play.
Well, and especially if you don't do that, now it's third and long against a team that hasn't really proven they can throw very well here in recent weeks. And that's exactly what Dabo Swinney's telling him right now.
And quite emphatically, I might add. The Wake Forest at its own 32. Perhaps the Demon Deacons can use a mistake by Clemson to put together a drive.
Timeout. Wake Forest. Their first time out of the half.
So Wake Forest will try to sort out what they want to do on first and 10 as they try to mount a drive down 14 against the Tigers. Celebrating its eighth year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate has donated more than $2.8 million in scholarship money. And first and 10 for Wake Forest after the roughing the passer penalty. Price throwing it into traffic and he threw it over the head of Campanaro, second and 10 coming.
You know, that last penalty by Spencer Shuey was another problem for Clemson because it's now allowed this drive to sustain. And, you know, you get a chance to get Wake Forest off the field on three downs right away. You put your up-tempo offense back on the field. You let them get after this defense again. Remember that up-tempo trying to wear out Wake Forest defensively. This penalty right here, though, prolonged this drive. It gave Wake Forest defense an opportunity to get with their coaches, try and figure out the juggernaut.
And Shuey standing on the sideline. Stephon Anthony's in. Out of the backfield, it's Harris. Josh Harris up close to the 40-yard line. He'll be about 2.5-3 yards short of the first down.
Wake Forest's greatest weapons in this game on offense, guys, are their running backs, right? Josh Harris and DeAndre Martin. So any way you can get them the football, you have to do that.
They'll mark him right at the 39. Need three. Wake Forest really needing to put together a drive.
There's that critical down and distance again. Third down for Wake Forest where they have to be great tonight. Only 1 for 4 so far.
Underneath the Campanaro, he's got the first down to the 45-yard line.
It's a great example of Mike Campanaro showing you how to get open underneath in zones. He was just running a hitch route, but he ended up breaking out of it when he found out he wasn't open. He uncovered himself, gave his quarterback a place to go with the ball.
Venables is going, there's one guy that can't beat us. Number 3. Come on, knuckleheads.
Brent, of course, name is very familiar. Spent 13 years on the staff of Bob Stoops at Oklahoma. Coming over to take over the defense of Clemson after the Orange Bowl debacle against West Virginia. They gave up 70 points, and Clemson fans, I'm sure, marking down. That's the first mention of the Orange Bowl tonight. Option look and halfback pass. Martin wants to throw, and I better put the football away. And the Clemson defense was ready for that one. Stephon Anthony, standout recruit a couple of years ago, makes the tackle.
Very smart play by DeAndre Martin here, guys. How many times do we see tailbacks when they have the opportunity to throw an option pass? They get a little bit of pressure, and they just throw it up for grabs downfield. That was smart. You weren't going to get a big play. Brett Venables knew it was going to be a halfback pass. We said Wake Forest would try some trickeration tonight. There's your first example.
Brett's a little too calm, don't you think? He probably needs to loosen up a little bit. Show some emotion.
And from that Stoops tree, they can get a little excitable about their defenses. Price throwing underneath. That's Jackson. Lavelle Jackson trying to turn the corner, and he cannot do it. Jonathan Willard there to make the stop. It'll be third down.
This is a very interesting design by Steve Lobotsky, the offensive coordinator from Wake Forest. It's almost a pick play. Watch Josh Harris. They're going to have a shallow cross coming this way. He's actually going to run out and lead block on the play. Watch him come out of the back. He was not really running a route. He's hunting up a defender to block him. so that when Jackson catches the football, it's basically a lead. It's an interesting design.
Maybe need to get a little better block on him.
You seal that edge?
Yeah. Seal that edge now. Third and six. Price hit. Very fortunate to hang on the football. Willard stopped the pass, and then he sacked the quarterback.
Willard said, I've seen enough of this. All right, enough of the option, enough of blocking me before you throw the football. Look at Venables. He brings the blitz. Little twist up. Great job by Willard getting a piece of that tackle. If he doesn't get a piece of the tackle right there, it doesn't help him use his momentum to get upfield. Come on, Venables.
You got to get back, coach. You got to keep Brent Venables back now.
Usually it's for the players, not the coaches.
Humphrey's going to let it hit. And the ball will bound into the end zone. And the Tigers will take over on their 20-yard line. Already up 14-0. And the defense starting to get into that Venables system. Off the field, big fella.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Mercedes-Benz. Experience truly great engineering today at your authorized dealer. And AT&T, the nation's largest 4G network. AT&T, rethink possible.
Donuts.
You could not pry those away from Davey this morning.
It's Krispy Kreme.
It was unbelievable. Davey's caloric intake this morning.
Krispy Kreme celebrating its 75th year. And a sweet run around the corner by Andre Ellington. Krispy Kreme, you just saw, donut chain founded here in Winston-Salem. And on football days, they do the Demon Deacon donut. Little black, little gold, the laces imprinted in the icing. You know what you saw, Davey, going after the icing?
Oh, my God. I mean, you couldn't keep him away from it. It was unbelievable. I thought, your body's a temple, Davey.
Taj is staying away from those this year, too, baby.
Taj, boy, oh, what a grab by Jerron Brown. And Brown is in the Wake Forest territory. Still on his feet inside the 40 before he's finally dragged down. And Clemson's on the move, threatening to turn this into a behind whipping.
I really feel for Wake
behind
Forest.
Behind whipping.
I feel for defensive coordinator Brian Noor here. There's so much offense you have to get ready for in a short week. They run the old pop pass, fake play action, hit the big 6'2" receiver over the middle of the field. Wow.
I'm showing him a little tempo, boy. Fires in. I think he skipped that one in the air to Nuke Hopkins.
You know what I mean? I mean, here you go. You got a short week, and consider the talent on Clemson's offense and all the explosive playmakers they have, the tempo at which they play at, and the volume of offense they run. I mean, that's just a recipe for disaster if you're a defense on a short week.
I mean, Clemson's one of the best defenses in the country, and we saw early in the season how much
offenses, you mean.
I'm sorry, FSU is one of the best defenses in the country, and you saw them struggle with the amount of plays that Clemson was able to do. So everybody is going to be challenged by this offense, especially on a short week.
Resetting the clock, that's the holdup here. So I guess what you're saying with Clemson's offense, they're getting their money's worth from Chad Morris, highest paid coordinator in college football. More money for Clemson on offense. Yet another wide receiver that you don't hear a lot about, but maybe the fastest of all of them, is Martavis Bryant.
Yeah, it's not bad enough that you got DeAndre Hopkins and Sammy Watkins. There are a lot of other guys where the football can go as well. And you know, this offense is at its best when it's balanced and different guys are touching the football. They had their worst offensive output last week against Virginia Tech. Only Andre Ellington, Hopkins, and Watkins caught the football.
You see the improvement in Clemson offense as Chad Morris has been there now his second year. Brown has it over the middle again. Brown making a living over the middle. He'll be close for first down. Let's see where they mark him down. Clemson marching it right down the field.
Boy, and it's so tough because you see Boyd run the read, and the linebackers have to honor the fake because he can run the football. Ellington can run it. Then you can hit right behind the linebackers, right where they come up to stop the run. Now they'll probably run it.
They do with Boyd. Josh keeps it. He's got the first down. He's down to 12.
See, what am I supposed to do? I mean, it really is an offense that has an answer for everything. Now, they're going to struggle if they get beat up front, but they're going to get numbers, and they're going to use the quarterback run, and it just makes it extremely difficult.
And that offensive line, Davey, is responding now. They were struggling earlier in this game. They're coming off the ball better on run plays, and they're giving Taj Boyd a very clean pocket to throw from.
Boyd firing into traffic, but right on the money. What a dart to Sam Cooper, the tight end. Touchdown, Clemson.
clean pocket to throw from, all that eye candy with the play fakes and the guys in motion. And again, it's just hard as a defense to understand where the football is. You're worried about Andre Ellington on it. You think you have that. You got five defenders around that receiver right there, and still Taj Boyd.
Tell you what, Taj Boyd kind of struggled down the stretch last year when people would drop everybody in coverage. That's what you call threading the needle. There is no defense to stop that. That was perfect throw. Risky, but perfect.
And you know, David, this is about the time when Taj started struggling now, and boy, has he been razor sharp tonight. 13 out of 16, three touchdowns, Clemson's rolling. CS standings out. Kansas State moving past Oregon at number three. Irish holding steady at five. Chance to move up. Ramp may play Oklahoma. Florida and Georgia, they're going to have to deal with the weather perhaps in Jacksonville. Alabama and Mississippi State. Mississippi State still undefeated. Boy, could they zoom up if they could upset the Tide. And Ohio also one of the 11 remaining undefeated teams. They're in the top 25. Hard to imagine the Bobcats of Frank Solich would move up, get into a BCS position, but you never know. BCS countdown sorts all of those types of things out. 8:30 Eastern time on ESPN. The three of us and Kirk Herbstreit, another half hour on ESPNU at 9 o'clock Eastern time. Our motto on the show, we understand the BCS, so you don't have to. Wake Forest will down it in the end zone. Should become a Coro with the catch, and Wake Forest will have it on the 25 after we check in with John Saunders.
Well, Reese, it's a SportsCenter update brought to you by Coors Light. NBA Commissioner David Stern has announced his retirement effective February of 2014, which will mark the 30th anniversary of him taking over the NBA. And, of course, many people feel he's responsible for bringing them into the 21st century.
Oh, you know, John, certainly David Stern has presided over unprecedented popularity in the NBA, retiring in 2014. I covered the NBA draft this year. The most popular man in the draft room is Adam Silver, who's the deputy commissioner who will take over. Short game by DeAndre Martin. And right now in the NBA draft, when Adam Silver comes out for the second round, the people go crazy, and it doesn't matter what Commissioner Stern does, they boo him. Now, when Silver ascends to the top spot, interesting to see if the crowd in the greater New York area boos him. Now, look at this. You see a 5-by-0 formation often, Jess?
Not very often at all.
Emptied out to a Tanner Price run. It'll be third and long.
And this is kind of like you feel the field goal team when they do this. They spread out on both sides. And watch what Clemson does on the outside. What they do, defensive end runs up the field real fast, takes it away automatically, takes away that throw to the flat so you don't get the advantage with the numbers game. And listen, you got to be ready for everything because Wake is definitely a little bit of option, a little bit of wildcat, a little bit of double pass.
Well, Clemson has gotten gashed on explosive plays because they've been misaligned. Right now, where's Mike Campanaro? There he is in the top of the slot. That's where they most likely are going if they're throwing.
Clemson sending linebacker. Price gets rid of it. Campanaro ought to have a first down. He does across the 35.
So Jesse just told Clemson's defense that that's who they want to throw to, and literally Clemson puts nobody on him. Not like, hey, dude, we're going to double team you because you're really good. Like, they literally didn't cover. Mental bust. You've seen this from Clemson all year long. Too many big plays, too many mental busts. If this defense could get halfway up to their offense, this is a team that you could talk about for making a championship.
I think it goes back to being aligned and understanding where key players are and understanding where your alignment has to be and not letting guys go uncovered. That's been a huge issue.
Price keeps it. Short gain on first down.
Now, Brent Venables, his system is a lot different this season. They're playing a lot more zone principles, where last year they were running a lot of man-to-man principles. So part of it, I think, is it's a new system. But here we are. We're 7-8 games into the season now. Guys have to understand where they need to line up on the field.
Kevin Steele was a blitz-happy guy. It was man-to-man coverage all the time. There's so much more to think about as a player. When somebody shifts in a zone coverage, in a man coverage, you go with him. In zone, you have to go, okay, who do I relate to next? And there's just a lot of things you have to worry about. Then you have to worry about him getting a grill, too.
Put a harness on Brent.
He's the 12th player right now.
Right down the middle and covered all over, and Travis Blanks was all over Campanaro.
Blanks is a safety by trade, playing a little bit of linebacker as well.
He was really the blanket on him. Yeah, he's the number two safety in high school coming out. Ooh, I think he got a little grab of that shoulder. Should have been a penalty. And I'm a quarterback, so of course I'm going to say that should have been PI.
And look at their defense, guys. I mean, if they can get this defense turned around going in the right direction, if everybody comes back next year, they're going to have some explosive playmakers. It's got to be the defense getting better.
I think they need to put a bridle on it. That's it. Just pulling back. Blanks now coming on the blitz. Price steps up, gets away for a moment, but not long enough. The sack from Vic Beasley, who Venable says is their best pure pass rusher. He was the first one there, and Wake will have to punt it again.
See, Venable still has some words for his young true freshman Travis Blanks from a play a little bit earlier, but you're going to see the pressure coming off the left-hand side. There's Vic Beasley. He was a running back in high school. Only 225 pounds, but he's a freak athlete. Shows you that speed coming up.
I love these D linemen with the single digits. It's so sweet.
Humphreys tries to avoid that first wave, but could not. So Clemson will have it back. Up 21-0. Taj Boyd going back to work. Tonight's Intelligent Move brought to you by Mercedes-Benz.
Clemson's offense has had tremendous bounce tonight throwing the football. It's not just all Sammy Watkins and DeAndre Hopkins, but Adam Humphreys, Martavius Bryant, Jerron Brown over the middle, the big tight end Brandon Ford in the red zone. Eight different receivers have touched the football tonight for Clemson.
And they'll keep it on the ground with Ellington and the first carrying key to Whitlock in there. Now we're going to keep an eye on Whitlock on this possession. Clemson, we assume, going to continue try to go up tempo, get a lot of snaps to see what impact it has on the Wake Forest defense and how quickly they can get the snaps off. Second and three. Flip to Watkins. Sammy's close to first down yardage. AJ Marshall there.
And they do so much of this, too, is something else that tires you out as a defense is they stretch you vertically and they stretch you horizontally as well. So they do the little dumps and the quick screens and the fly sweeps. So as a defensive lineman, you got to run all the way to the sidelines and run all the way back. And they're playing at a fast tempo. It definitely takes a toll.
Watkins digging enough for the first down. It'll slow the tempo a little bit because the left guard moved.
False start, 68 offense, 5 yards, first down.
I don't mind that.
As a defense?
Thank you very much.
I'll take that.
Appreciate that. I'll take the extra 20, 30 seconds to breathe.
And Taj Boyd's looking at his left guard right now. He's like, dude, you're killing our advantage right now. We're trying to go fast. We need you here. Hold your water.
There's Whitlock. He's double teamed. Boyd, a lot of time. Boyd going to take a shot. Wide open is Sammy Watkins. And if the ball had been out in front, Sammy would have scored again. But he has his third explosive play of the night.
You're going to see how quickly now Taj Boyd, a quarterback, runs down the field with the rest of the offensive linemen to get set up quickly. Taj Boyd looking at Chad Morris on the sidelines, getting the play call in so he can communicate that with his offensive line and his wide receivers. You see Nikita Whitlock now, hands on the waist. He's just had to jog the length of the field now. He's getting tired.
Watkins' third catch of 50 or longer tonight. Boyd is knocked down. Joey Ehrman gets it.
I think one of the improvements in the offense this year for Clemson, they're actually playing faster. Last year ran the second most total offensive snaps in the country, but because of Taj Boyd's pre-snap mechanics, looking to the sidelines and communicating everything, they're running between 5 and 7 more plays a game.
Right around 20 seconds on that snap. Boyd is incomplete. It'll be third down and 10.
And that's the one thing that you've seen, but watch the hurry up. Watch what you have to go through as a defensive lineman. We want the oxygen. This is what it does to you. It doesn't let you get all that oxygen you want to breathe in, but that's the one area that Taj Boyd struggles with. If you can hit him, make him feel a little bit uncomfortable, his footwork gets a little bit sloppy. If you want to stop this offense, you got to hit him.
They don't hit him that time, and Boyd fires it to Newt Hopkins, and it's another touchdown pass for Clemson. This time, 12 yards, 27-0, the 18th-ranked Tigers cruising.
The one common denominator in recent touchdown passes for Taj Boyd tonight, look at the protection up front. They got five guys blocking. Andre Ellington can get out on his route, but there is nobody near him on that throw. And they give him a tunnel to throw into. Remember, he's only 6'1". He's not very tall. So it's easy to find those receivers when you got that much space.
He threw that about 6 feet off the ground. Did you see that thing?
It's like my 2-iron.
Right over top.
DeAndre Hopkins hadn't put up the big numbers so far, but now he's in the end zone. Clemson's up here. Saturday night on ABC, undefeated Notre Dame going in to take on the Sooner Schooner. Two of the top three winning percentages in the history of the sport. The Irish with an opportunity to prove themselves to the doubters against 8th-ranked Oklahoma, 8 o'clock Eastern time on ABC. College Game Day is going to be there. What a scene that is going to be in Norman. Bradley Pinion kicks it out of the back of the end zone. Wake Forest going to try it again from the 25. Time for John Saunders in the studio.
Reese, want to remind everyone, coming up, it's a Land Rover halftime report. The big one, as you talked about, Notre Dame and Oklahoma will preview that Saturday game on ABC. We'll also have the lightning round pick'em, plus the May Day Minute. Time for his return. Reese, back to you. See you at halftime.
All right, John, we'll look forward to it. Both those guys, Sammy Watkins and Nuke Hopkins, have caught touchdown passes tonight. In fact, Taj Boyd's thrown four of them to four different receivers. Our gaining Wake Forest are the Tigers, 326 to 60. Josh Harris doesn't get much. Well, a lot of attention is going to be on that Notre Dame-Oklahoma game this weekend. Final full practice for the Sooners, which they'll play on Saturday, have a little walkthrough on Friday.
I always felt like as a player, those practices, especially late in the week leading up to big games, there was just a different feel to them. There was more focus. Guys were more dialed in. There was a seriousness involved during that week.
Second and 7. Tanner Price sacked again. This time it was Malachi Goodman, a senior from Florence, South Carolina, and it's a rough night for Tanner Price.
Malachi Goodman's really been coming on in his last two games. You're going to see him here coming off the edge. Brent Venables wants him to play with more violence and more of a frantic energy. It's a little bit like David Pollock right there coming off the line.
My man. Well, I'll tell you what he doesn't have. I'll tell you what he has, what I didn't. That dude's got some long arms. I mean, he's got some measurables. He can put it all together. Man, he's got a good frame.
Third sack of the night for Clemson. They only had 9, barely in the top 100 in the country. Flip it out to Josh Harris. Football's on the ground. It was recovered immediately by Josh Watson. And it is a fumble, and Clemson will have it in the red zone. Cortez Davis, the freshman, stripped it free, and the wheels are off the wagon for the Demon Deacons.
Clemson's defense this year has given up a lot of yards, and they've given up a lot of points. One thing they've done a great job of, guys, takeaways. Second in the conference with 15 heading into tonight. And there's one of those young, inexperienced cornerbacks, Cortez Davis, only had 15 career snaps heading into tonight, making his presence felt here in this first half.
And I'll tell you one thing about defense. Fumbles are a lot luck. But when you have guys swarm into the football, multiple guys, you can get the hand in there, you can get the head in there, the shoulder in there. When you see that swarm, a lot of times good things happen.
Clemson will reverse, a block from Taj Boyd. Sharon Brown has, no, check that, that's Sharon Peak, 19 rather than 18.
So it's plays like that that force you to keep honest as a defense. Because we've seen guys in motion all night, faking reverses, faking handoffs. But now that he actually gives it to somebody on a reverse, now defensive end and linebackers, they got to stay home, and you have to honor that as this game goes on.
If I'm a Clemson fan, I'm going, all right, now, we're having success. Don't let Boyd block. I don't need his shoulder getting dinged up. I don't need him getting hurt blocking a defensive lineman. Let my man sling the pill because he's been doing a good job of it.
The guy down for Wake Forest is Hassan Hazimi. He's a graduate student, played at Akron, transferred to Wake Forest. He's the guy that Boyd
put a headgear and shoulder into.
And smart by Taj Boyd, because he blocks him without his throwing shoulder. If you can, always block with the lead shoulder that you're not using to throw the football with. Veteran move by Taj Boyd.
You know, you grow in experience, you learn.
Eat less.
Take care of your body.
There you go, yeah.
That boy's going to run it. And again, he led in very wisely into the tackle with the left shoulder that time. Saw the guy coming, lead in with the non-throwing shoulder.
Taking care of his body right now. Taking care of this offense right now. They've been virtually unstoppable here on their last several possessions, whether it's been throwing it or running it. This red zone area, this is where Taj Boyd can do some damage.
Where's Mr. Whitlock that we bragged on to start the game, too? Big man in the middle. Little big man in the middle needs to make some plays.
DJ Howard in motion. Now Taj has a little running room. Can get to the corner. He can. He's inside the 10 and steps out of bounds inside the 5. First and goal for Clemson.
You know, last year at midway through the season, he ballooned. He added 20 pounds midway through. This year, he's been able to keep his weight at 225. And this is the end result, guys. That's not a called running play. He's trying to throw the football. Nothing there. He's able to use his quickness and his speed, get outside, convert a huge third down in the red zone.
Teammates started calling him Fat Boy last year.
Yeah, he didn't care for that much.
No. First and goal, he's lean, mean, touchdown throwing machine tonight, and he's got another one. 15 to Sherron Peak. Or 5 to Sherron Peak tonight, I should say. 5 touchdown passes, 5 different guys. He beat number 15, Allen Ramsey, and is 34-0.
So it's a pick your poison dilemma now if you're Wake Forest. You got to stack the box to stop Taj Boyd from hurting you running the football, which means you leave a freshman corner, Allen Ramsey, one-on-one with a wide receiver that's 6'3". And you can't win. I mean, what do you do right now if you're Wake Forest? You can't win.
I think they can't win in a lot of aspects. With Buck 18 going, offensively challenged team. Down by 35, Taj Boyd has tied a career high with 5 touchdown passes in the first half. Tigers have put 28 on the board this quarter, and they're cruising.
Your new business really needs new business. Get the word out with the HP OfficeJet Pro. Professional color printing for 50% less per page than laser. Making an impact, it matters.
Now the man of the night has been Taj Boyd. 17 of 21, that's 4 incomplete passes, 5 touchdown passes. Always a good ratio when you're throwing more touchdowns than incompletions. Tigers on the road. They're 1-9 on Thursday night during the ESPN Thursday Night Football era. That is going to change. The kick out of the back of the end zone and Wake Forest. A minute 18 to go in the first half. Look at what Taj Boyd did on that last drive.
So it's not just when he has the football in his hands, but he's throwing blocks, getting guys open on double reverses. Plays break down downfield. No sweat. Go get it with my legs. And then I throw a little fade here, a little dime piece the corner of the end zone for the score.
And you know why I'd be excited if I'm a Clemson fan? Because Clemson's been a team over the years that in this kind of spot that has sometimes sputtered, not looked good, not taking care of business, have had some bad losses on the resume in the past, just coming out, taking care of business like they should.
Well, last year, David's a prime example of that. Now, Wake Forest had a bowl team last year. He still got a chance to go to a bowl this year. Quick completion to Terrence Davis, but when Wake Forest came into Death Valley a year ago, Clemson had an opportunity to clinch the ACC Atlantic. Ended up winning it on a field goal, final play of the game, but really it was sort of indicative of one of those performances you were talking about. They were sloppy, they turned the football over. Really, Wake Forest, a great chance to win that game. They were up 2 touchdowns with 5 to go in the third quarter. Campanaro dragged down by Stephon Anthony, but tonight, they played to a standard. There is a flag on the field. If you were with us at the top of the broadcast, Devo Swinney was talking to his team, talking about playing to a standard.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle. Number 9 to the defense, 15-yard penalty. First down.
Clemson's defense tonight, guys, I think has been perfect with the exception of a couple bad penalties. But this is, and I know Wake Forest is banged up on offense. correct. They're not the 49ers under Bill Walsh. I get that. But this
or, defense, or under Jim Harbaugh.
But this defense looks way better than they did even a couple weeks ago.
Tanner Price, Tommy Bohannon. A short gains. We're inside a minute to play in the first half.
Bohannon's a cool little story, too. I mean, he's a little fullback, splits out as a fourth wide receiver, fifth wide receiver. He's a nice little player. Give him some love. He deserves it. Does the dirty stuff.
Price, another completion, and now loses Terrence Davis, and Davis steps out of bounds inside the 20.
One of the biggest issues Clemson has had is missed tackles, especially in the secondary. That's going to drive Brent Venables crazy when they put the film on. When guys are in space, you have to make a play and get him down the first time. That's not an example of that right there.
Wake Forest trying to end what's been a disastrous half on a high note. Pressure for Price. Runs out of time, and down he goes. Corey Crawford was the first one there. There is a flag on the play.
Personal foul, face mask. Number 93 defense. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
Another major penalty against Clemson on this drive, and Corey Crawford, who was the first guy there, got a hold of Price's face mask.
This penalty should have never happened because Tanner Price had the one-on-one he wanted outside. You see him looking at it. He should have let go of the football right there. Instead, he held on to it. Yep. But Crawford's got to know. Obviously, can't grab the face mask, keep the drive alive now inside the 10.
Price under the edge, gets out of bounds and stops the clock with 18 seconds left in the half.
Yeah, but how much? I mean, you got to give him a little bit of credit too for hanging in because he's getting dinged around the last three or four series. And he's hanging there, being there tough. They're trying to do what they can. Nice little 2 minute here to get something going. Well, get the ball at the half.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to say, it's 35-0. A lot of people think this game's over, but if you're Wake Forest, if you can get a touchdown right now, get the football back, you know, try to build some momentum.
Build momentum, but the game's,
you know.
Price throwing to the end zone. It's a touchdown for Wake Forest, and there's Pollock's guy, Tommy Bohannon, his fourth touchdown catch of the season.
You don't see fullbacks going out playing receiver. Their job is to hit people. See linebacker, hit linebacker. A great job. They put him out. It was basically a little slot receiver on the outside. Look at that. Matched up outside on a safety. Look at the man. Catch the football. Nicely done, son.
Nice grab for the senior from North Fort Myers, Florida. Chad Hedlund, who's taken over the kicking duties for Wake Forest. Tack on the extra point, and he does. So Wake Forest will get it first in the second half and get on the board before halftime. Tanner Price leading his team down the field, and Bohannon finding it in the end zone for the score. This stadium, BB&T Field, just seats 31,500, but there's a grassy area in the end zone to our right, just beneath the big Jumbotron. See a lot of families out there enjoying themselves. Great night for football in Winston-Salem, although probably not the greatest night if you live and die with the Demon Deacon. So Wake Forest just got on the board. 35-7 now, 18th-ranked Clemson with the lead. Students still into it. With 12 seconds remaining in the half. Low line drive kick is Martavis Bryant. Bryant has great straight line speed, but couldn't get going in a straight line. Stopped short of the 20. Cincinnati and Louisville, 8 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN Friday night. Battle in the Big East. Both teams unbeaten in conference play. Louisville unbeaten overall behind Teddy Bridgewater. Watch the game on ESPN. Also available live on Watch ESPN.
Yeah, I expect Butch Jones's football team to have a fire lit underneath them. You mentioned that loss last week against Toledo. Of course, it doesn't affect them in the Big East race. Huge conference game on the road tomorrow night. Two very interesting quarterbacks, Teddy Bridgewater and Munchie Legault. It'll be a lot of fun to watch.
Taj Boyd's been a boatload of fun to watch in the first half. He's thrown for 286 yards, tied a career high with 5 touchdown tosses, and Clemson is firmly in control, 35-7 as we head to halftime. Tigers have gone on the road and taken care of business. Five different receivers, including DeAndre Nuke Hopkins, caught touchdown passes tonight for Dabo Swinney's team. He stands by with Sam Steele.
Coach, obviously you're doing something right with 35 points on the board, but Coach Morris told me he needed to see improvement from your O-line tonight. What's your assessment there?
Well, we started off a little slow, kind of going outside and weren't really getting much at the point of attack, but they've settled in. We've done a nice job of our little power wide zone play, and you know, guys are executing. They're in a rhythm now, but I tell you, our quarterback's playing lights out. He's in a zone, spreading the ball around to a lot of different guys, and you know, right now we're playing really well. Unfortunately, we gave up a touchdown, you know, too many penalties and a big missed tackle, but you know, we got a whole other half to play, so a lot of ball left.
Your son Clay told me you'd win by 21, so you're well on your way. Thanks, Coach.
Okay, thank you.
Guys.
And he has spread it around. Nine different receivers have caught passes. Clemson up 35-7. Time to join John Saunders, Mark May, Ryan Greasy with the Land Rover Halftime Report.
Fighting Irish facing Oklahoma. You can see it on ABC, 8 o'clock Eastern time. Five touchdown passes in the first half. Clemson win 35-7. Land Rover going above and beyond, much like Sammy Watkins, who has had a terrific game. Five receptions for 177 yards and a touchdown. Might have had another. 35-7 at half.
Welcome back to College Football Primetime on ESPN, served by Applebee's.
Let's have a little fun tonight.
Clemson, the one getting their good time on the ACC on ESPN, just about set to kick off the second half. BB&T Field, Winston-Salem, North Carolina. The Tigers ranked 18th in BCS with a 35-7 lead over Wake Forest. Stephen Deacon's going to get the ball to start the second half. Scored just before halftime. Get on the board after Clemson had jumped on top 35-0. Kick will go out of the back of the end zone. Wake will start on the 25. Take a look at our coaching adjustments brought to you by the Home Depot.
Hey, Thursday night, only show in town. You gotta love it.
Quarterback Taj Boyd has been the sheriff in town tonight. I mean, he's having his tour de force performance. He's only thrown four incompletions. He's playing unconscious, whether he's throwing it underneath, over the middle of the field in the intermediate areas, or going deep to Sammy Watkins. Taj Boyd has not missed tonight, throwing five touchdown passes. He's made plays with his legs as well.
Tanner Price trying to answer. His first pass is incomplete. Here is Boyd. He's thrown five touchdown passes to five different receivers. That ties a Clemson record. He and Cullen Harper share it. One more for Taj would give him the record outright. You mentioned Watkins. He's set a career high in yardage with five catches for 177 yards. In fact, if Sammy gets a 25-yard catch, he'll double his output for the season. Wake Forest keeping on the round, giving it to Campanero and around to pick up a first down as we check in with Samantha Steele.
Yeah, Reese, I talked to Jim Grobe coming out of the half, and I asked him to diagnose what the main problem was. He said, well, just like we've been seeing, they've been giving up way too many explosive plays. He said, to be honest, we're not used to seeing speed like this. We need to respect their speed in the second half, expect them to play a lot more contained here, guys.
Campanero had a shot down the middle of the field, Sam. Tanner Price couldn't hit him. It'll be second and 10.
Interesting now to see Wake Forest's offense, if they can build on that momentum, getting that late touchdown in the first half, coming out with possession, already trying to get Mike Campanero involved. You saw in a reverse, now trying to find him down the middle of the field. Got to get it to your best player.
Campanero! There, get it to Campanero again. Campanero stopped by Spencer Shewing.
And this is a situation they desperately did not want to be in. Definite passing situations. Clemson knows they have to spread it around now. They have to do something that they're not really good at. I mean, their left tackle is playing with a torn ACL. How do you think that feels in pass protection?
Stephen Chase, 73, has been one of the gutsy players. Bryce buying a little time on third down, trying to convert, now firing it deep, and nobody home at the 20-yard line. It'll be fourth down for the Deeks.
You're going to see Stephen Chase, who Davey was just talking about, who suffered an ACL back in August, didn't get surgery because they were so thin, so just deciding to play with the injury. So he's got one ACL in his body right now.
That's a grown man.
Yeah.
I mean toughing it out for the team. You deserve the courage award, the toughness award, something at the banquet at the end of the year. He's going to get something.
You know, they were splitting snaps with him, and then they got so thin, they finally said, hey, Stephen, you think you can go the whole way? Adam Humphries, he got spun around by the face mask, and things not going well for Demon Deacons. 15 yards tacked on to the end of that return. Jerry Magalanes is our referee.
Personal foul, horse collar on the kicking team. 15 yards, first down.
My mistake, not a face mask and a horse collar. It was the upper extremity. Well, you know, I was right. I was right and they were wrong. I saw his head spin around. Either way, it's 15 yards. So ball winds up same place at the 39-yard line as I peer underneath the camera and over our monitors. Reese Davis, Jesse Palmer, and David Pollock here. You look at Clemson tonight, obviously an impressive performance. Wake Forest team is struggling. What does this say to you about the Tigers?
Well, I think when they're balanced, they're at their most dangerous. And we talked a lot about Sammy Watkins. We talked a lot about DeAndre Hopkins. But all of a sudden, a guy like Martavius Bryant can get involved, or Jerron Brown, or Brandon Ford at tight end. When Taj Boyd's able to distribute the football to other guys, it's just too many weapons for a defense to have to worry about, and they're unstoppable.
Well, how about when he gets the football back? How about when they play a little bit of defense? And they've gotten better over the past couple of weeks, and they get more possessions. They allow their tempo to do more damage. And then you see, obviously, the more they touch it, the more they're going to score. So I think if the defense can continue to turn around, it could beat anybody. I mean, they could do that last year if they could get some kind of defense.
You think last year's experience and the way they struggled down the stretch, bounced back, won the ACC, but then had the embarrassment in the Orange Bowl. What effect, David, do you think that had on this program in general? And get your thoughts after Taj Boyd perhaps throws another touchdown pass. There's Martavis Bryant. An excellent coverage by Kevin Johnson. Good corners for Wake Forest tonight. Now, they've given up some plays. Everybody has, but a couple of talented guys, including Johnson, at one corner for the Deacons.
You know, I think that just goes to show you how dangerous Clemson can be, because, Reese, I think Wake Forest's corners, Bud Noel and Kevin Johnson, are one of the best tandems in the entire country. We've seen Sammy Watkins and DeAndre Hopkins and these other receivers have success outside. That just shows you the depth that Clemson has in these playmakers on the perimeter.
Boyd slanting here a little bit early. It looked like Johnson was getting there early. No flags flying.
So Wake Forest wants to put a lot of bodies in the box to try and stop Taj Boyd in this running game. So they're putting their corners on islands. They knew they were going to have to do that in the game. Kevin Johnson, only 175 pounds. They were worried he wouldn't be physical enough tonight, but showing you some physicality there.
It's not pass interference, if I don't call it.
Clemson's 5-for-7 on third down. Ellington in the flat, trying to stay in bounds. I think he got away with stepping out. He's pushed out anyway. Daniel Mack coming up to shove Ellington out. It'll be fourth down for the Tigers. Now, how long? Hey, it's just a 20. I say just, but a 28-point game. How long do you leave Boyd, some of the starters in the game here?
You know, I think getting ready to go on the stretch run, you know, I think you play him at least through the end of the third quarter. You've come out early now in your first drive. You've stalled. You want them going out on the right foot. I don't see why you'd have to play him going into the fourth.
I don't see why you play him anymore, period.
Bell Jackson lets it hit.
Taj Boyd gets hurt. Your season is very much in flux. It might be over competitively. I mean, it's tough.
Clemson's up huge in the third. NASCAR NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Martinsville. That's just about 45 minutes away from where we are in Winston-Salem. And with a Demon D, that's not safe, hanging his head out the window while he's going for a little spin in the car.
Buckle up, dog.
Coverage starts on ESPN Sunday, 1 o'clock Eastern Time, NASCAR Sprint Cup Countdown. There is the reigning champion and three-time NASCAR Sprint Cup champion, Tony Stewart, enjoying the game here. Short little ride from Martinsville. Wake Forest stopped on first down. It'll be second and 10 there.
Smoke.
There is Smoke Stewart. Tony, an aggressive driver. Aggressive drivers get things done. It's a short track at Martinsville. It'll be a little rub in his racing. Might be a racing deal or two.
Ask him if he wants any of Reese Davis in a lawnmower racing contest.
He does not. He's 0-1.
0-1, Tony.
Undefeated, untied.
Enterprise to Sherman Ragland III. And Sherman's been dealing with an abdominal injury, coming back and playing tonight. It'll be third and down to just finish up David's story, which clearly I've shared with him on a couple of occasions. Back in another phase of my career when I hosted the RPM show, Tony Stewart was gracious enough to come be on the show, and we went to the Home Depot in Southington, Connecticut, and raced lawnmowers down the aisle. I put him right into a pallet of lumber and won the race, as I recall. I hope there's not video taped evidence otherwise. There's a third down pass incomplete, but there is a flag on the field. There's also a Clemson player a little slow to get up. That's Vic Beasley.
Tanner Price would like to have this throw back. He had a wide open Brandon Terry streaking down the right sidelines. They were trying to go to a double move. Tanner Price got off his receiver way too early. I mean, right now, Brandon Terry could be running into the goalpost. Tanner Price sticks with his read. It's a missed opportunity.
Right now. He was just finished.
As in right now.
Just crossed.
You know, Price last year threw for more than 3,000 yards and 20 touchdowns. He had Chris Givens with him. This is a different challenge for the Wake Forest quarterback, a junior from Austin, Texas. And Clemson has the 35-7 lead, about to get the ball back, much to the delight of the future Tiger cheerleaders who made the trek here to BB&T Field to watch their favorite team play. Vizio BCS standings through week 8. Remember, this is an incomplete portrait. All the hues and the contrast have not been added, but you see the teams at the top of Kansas State slipping past Oregon for at least the time being, moving into that third spot. Notre Dame and Oklahoma is just going to be huge. Obviously, yeah. Florida and Georgia as well. Alabama, Mississippi State. Kansas State has Texas Tech just out of that panel in 14th. Andre Ellington fumbled the football out of bounds. Clemson will maintain possession.
And I think it's a huge week for Oregon. Huge week. They play Colorado, but Florida plays Georgia. You look at Kansas State playing Texas Tech. I mean, you look at Notre Dame playing Oklahoma. You're looking at, you know, 2, 3, and 5. You know, all right there in, you know, in Oregon, distance of Oregon. They can make up some ground by just winning.
Oregon will get theirs in November. Don't worry.
Well, they'll take care of business, too. They have Colorado.
So they can, yeah, they'll take care of that this weekend, start gearing up for a road to the Coliseum at USC, and then a home game against Stanford. Who knows, guys? Maybe an undefeated Oregon State team on the road in the Civil War. A lot of big games still to come for Chip Kelly and the Ducks.
And then potentially another game against USC in the Pac-12 championship game. We were talking about on BCS Countdown Sunday night. Boyd throwing to Martavis Bryant. Bryant, what a grab. Oh, what a crew of receivers. Dabo Swinney can run out there. Bryant, 6'5", 200-pound sophomore, picks up 34.
So you have Sammy Watkins and DeAndre Hopkins. They're not even your fastest wide receiver. Martavis Bryant at 6'5", has been clocked at around a 4.4 in the 40-yard dash. And he shows you the wheels right there on the wheel route. And a perfect throw. Again by Taj Boyd.
Ellington slips a couple of tacklers and gets inside the 15. And how about the recruiting class? Now, DeAndre Hopkins wasn't part of it. He's a year older. He's a junior. Sammy Watkins, sophomore. Saw Sherron Pete catch a touchdown pass earlier. Sophomore. Martavis Bryant, sophomore. Adam Humphries, who's returning punch for them, sophomore. Oh, young receivers. dynamic ones. Ellington trying to get to the corner, and he's knocked down. It'll be third and long.
You see Sammy Watkins, DeAndre Hopkins now out of the game. So the coach is taking those receivers out. He's getting some of these other guys more experience. Going to need these two horses down the road. They got a lot to play for still. They don't control their destiny in the ACC, but if they win out the rest of their games, they can finish 11-1 with a chance at an at-large spot in a BCS bowl game.
Going to work their way into the top 14, and the computers don't like them at all right now. They're 13 in the human polls. The computer rank is 27. That's why it has them dragged down to 18.
Indictment on the ACC, isn't it?
It is. Boyd tries to get away, and he throws it backwards. That's a backwards pass, and they're calling it down. Wow. I'm not so sure. Nikita Whitlock was the guy there. That wasn't the smartest play Taj has made tonight.
Look, double, hey, listen to me now. Listen to me. You can read his lips. Just stay in the moment. You're playing great football. Don't do anything stupid. Watch Nikita Whitlock up the middle, just not cooperating, beating the double team, backs right into the quarterback, Taj Boyd. Looked like he wanted to throw that out of bounds sideways, and Zach Thompson got his hand on it.
Yeah, they need to look at that again. He was not down, in my judgment, from here.
Wow.
And they're giving him a chance for a 48-yard field goal. Chandler Catanzaro has made 20 consecutive field goals. Catanzaro has the distance, but he does not have the accuracy. So all's well that ends well, I guess. Ball should have been marked a little farther back, I believe, but missed the field goal. The streak is over, but Clemson is going to roll. A teachable moment, coaches like to say, as Taj Boyd got away with one.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by the all-new 2013 Ford Escape. It's what happens when you go further. Ag Windows.
Haunted house on campus. Eliciting screams very similar to the ones you might have heard from the Wake Forest defensive staff tonight. 35-7. Clemson has been showing off. A myriad of receivers. Big, fast, strong, sticky hands. DeAndre Hopkins, Sammy Watkins, both with touchdowns. Wake Forest has had no answers. Enterprise firing. He had a man open. It was Terrence Davis. He missed him. Second and 10. We check in with John Saunders.
Time for the AT&T All-America Player of the Week. Seth Degen tossing it around for Texas Tech. 30 of 42 for 318 yards and 7 touchdowns in a win against TCU. You want to vote? Text to 34763.
All right, John Dagey's putting together a great season as Josh Harris gets up close to the 40-yard line. Jesse, you have him at least on your Heisman radar.
Yeah, I think he should be in the Heisman conversation right now, guys. He's thrown 13 touchdowns the last 2 weeks in big wins, one at home against West Virginia, one on the road in triple OT against a good team in TCU. He's already thrown as many touchdowns now as he did all last year, and he's got a Heisman moment opportunity this week on the road at K-State.
That's the guy who is presumed to be the Heisman frontrunner, at least at the moment, Colin Klein. Wake Forest keeps it on the ground. Harris in the open field. If Josh Harris has the Jets, he does not. He'll be tracked down inside the 20, but Wake Forest threatening again. Jonathan Meek saved the touchdown.
And this is what you see. Look at, watch the two linebackers right here inside. Watch what they do. Both come downhill, run right up in the middle, like blind dogs in a meat market, right out of the way. You see an easy cut. How about the hustle, though? Nice hustle to run it down on the backside, maybe save 7.
Price throwing the end zone. Bohannon, touchdown, Wake Forest.
You cannot stop the Bohannon. It's impossible. Bohannon, fullback, hits you in the mouth. Then he splits out wide and says, watch, he's in the slot, little wheel route.
I'm just going to go ahead and run the double move.
Beautiful.
He's just gonna, like, stop
he,
down.
He acted like he was blocking out on the corner. Little nice patience. Goes in his edge. I might throw it to Bohannon.
Are you sure that guy's a fullback? Are you sure he's a fullback?
Really?
Look at it. Look at his.
Really?
Look at the guns. Wow. He's a fullback.
35-14 with the extra point.
Ooh.
And
shit.
Without the extra point, it's 35-13.
It's like my golf swing.
So 13 straight points for Wake Forest. Not, you know, it's only a 22-point game. Still a lot of time to go. And, you know, you wonder if Clemson's lost its edge just a little bit. Great lineup Saturday night on ESPN and ABC. Ohio State, number 9 in the Associated Press because of probation, ineligible to be ranked in the coaches' poll with the BCS. They'll take on Penn State. What a job Bill O'Brien's done.
Watch out. Won 5 games in a row. Very different-looking team than when they lost against Ohio at home in week 1. And Matt McGloin has been lights out. Bill O'Brien's done a great job with them.
And that Ohio loss doesn't really seem that bad now because they're undefeated as well. Mississippi State at 8:30 Eastern time, undefeated, going down Highway 82 to take on Alabama. They're saying we believe all over campus and Start Vegas that they can go to 8-0 for the first time since 1999. Dan Mullen wrapping up the bulk of preparations today as old Bully gets ready to make that trek over and try to knock off the number 1 team in the country.
A lot of people believe we're going to find out a lot about Alabama. I think we're going to find out a lot about Mississippi State. Their only SEC games this year against Auburn, Kentucky, and Tennessee, a combined 0-14 in conference play.
Over Watkins' head, Clemson will get it on the 25. And, you know, Mississippi State finally got that line removed from the Dan Mullen resume. They hadn't beaten anybody in the SEC West, not named Ole Miss, by beating Auburn. But as you mentioned, Auburn certainly struggled. Now, State, you know, historically, their defense has given Alabama problems. Great cornerback play. Do you expect to see more of the same Saturday night?
I don't. I don't think Mississippi State can match the physicality of Alabama up front at the line of scrimmage. Mississippi State all year has done a great job creating turnovers. But Alabama doesn't give it up. They've only had 6 giveaways all year long. I think the advantage is clearly for Alabama.
Well, I definitely think the advantage is for Alabama. I don't think anybody can dispute that. They open as over a 21-point favorite against an undefeated team. But they're playing, Alabama's playing at home, obviously a huge advantage. But I do want to see those receivers on the outside. That Cooper's starting to step up, and I think he's going to be the go-to guy. But other than that, you put a first-round corner, Jonathan Banks, on him to shut him down. Maybe commit an extra guy to the box and see what you can do and try to make it a ball game. And also, Tyler Russell will be the best quarterback that they've faced yet now because he's slinging it. And he's got a big arm. You can see it a little bit.
You said that last week. Who's better, Tyler Bray or Tyler Russell?
Well, Tyler Russell's better. I mean, he's
really?
He's had a better season,
really?
No doubt.
Better season.
Really.
But he's a better quarterback?
Well, he's playing better right now, absolutely.
He's been a better offense maybe, but he's not a better quarterback than Tyler Bray.
He's playing better than Tyler Bray. 17 touchdowns, 1 interception.
Who's he had to play against?
Auburn. He played against Tennessee. He out-dueled Tennessee. He killed Tennessee.
Well, Tennessee scored a lot of points, too.
But
no one was playing defense in that game.
But at any rate, we're splitting it. Both guys have put up numbers. Tyler Russell, as you see, some against Tennessee and against Auburn. Russell has been outstanding. Kid out of Tupelo that Alabama heavily recruited, by the way. Darius Perkins gives him balance on the ground.
Yeah, number 1 running back right now in the SEC. It's a very balanced offense, but they've not yet seen anything like what they're going to line up against.
And you know what? They don't have – Tyler Bray has legitimate wide receivers on the outside. Mississippi State has nobody on the outside.
Yeah, they're going to
beat man coverage. Yeah, I mean
– Bumpus and Smith are pretty good.
They're okay. They're senior guys that are experienced. I'll give them that. But nobody that's a burner. Nobody like a Justin Hunter.
Speaking about good receiver tandems, where would you guys stack up Clemson? When you look at Sammy Watkins and DeAndre Hopkins, in your guys' minds, where are they when you compare them to other great duos across the country?
Fully healthy?
Yeah.
Fully ingrained in the offense, not with a suspension and hurt. If you told me I had to pick from anybody in the country, I'd pick these two.
Anybody in the country?
Yep, I'd pick those two.
I will disagree with you strongly.
Taj Boyd fires complete. Another catch for DeAndre Hopkins. Here are some other choices in terms of receiver duos. I wouldn't fault anybody who decided to choose Hopkins and Watkins or any of these guys, really. I think I might go to L.A.
I'm going to go right here.
Yep.
Marquise Lee and Robert Woods, potentially 2 first-round picks. If you tell me I have to play in an I-formation offense and I only get 2 receivers on the field, I will gladly line up with Marquise Lee and Robert Woods each and every snap.
Okay, you think those guys are 2 first-rounders to support David's point. Could you not say the same about Hopkins and Watkins?
I think they're both 2 first-rounders as well. I just think with respect to route running, with respect to one guy like Marquise Lee, I think Marquise Lee is the best of all of them.
And I think Robert Woods is unbelievable.
I think Watkins is the best of all of them.
And I would also say Oregon State, Brandon Cooks and Marcus Wheaton.
Ballers.
Have been unbelievable as well.
They've been the most productive out of all those besides Austin and Bailey. They've been over 100 yards, both of them, every single game. They've been more productive.
And we saw that list. What about staying in the ACC? I'm going to give Duke some love. With Connor Vernon and Jamison Crowder, they've had an unbelievable duo this year throwing the football as well. Give them some love.
Vernon set the ACC record for receptions. Boyd firing down the middle, and he fired too high. Perhaps fortunate that that wasn't intercepted. He was looking for Hopkins.
Here's what the Knights look like so far. Everybody wondered what's wrong with Sammy Watkins. Hasn't yet had a breakout game. Didn't yet have a receiving touchdown pass. Well, he's having a career night tonight, whether it's been running comebacks, working deep downfield. DeAndre Hopkins has been a weapon in the red zone as well. These two guys alone, very, very tough to stop. We've seen some other weapons in this passing offense, too.
Third down and six for the Tigers. Whitlock almost jumped offside. Didn't make contact, got back.
Sees the blitz coming, looking straight down low.
Pressure coming, they get to him. Boyd's hit and he goes down. It's a sack. Justin Jackson coming from his linebacker position.
Justin Jackson's an incredible athlete. He's playing linebacker, but they don't switch personnel because of his speed. You're going to see him right here. He ran a 10.7 in the 100 meter in high school, showing you that athleticism, that quickness. He gets there in a hurry.
70, Mr. Timothy just swing and a miss, strike one.
With the whiff, someone once said. Lavelle Jackson back, Spencer Benton to punt it away for Clemson. Pressure on him. Wake almost got to it. Jackson, he'll clear out of there. Oh, and then he decides to catch it on the hop. He saved Wake a few yards. Fortunately for him, he saved the football as well. Hey, little under 4.5 to go in the third quarter. Don't look now. Demon Deacons put together a drive and another score. They could be back in this thing. Right now, Clemson up by 22.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
Wake Forest, the only touchdown of the second half. They just came up with a sack of Taj Boyd, and certainly it's a steep hill. Time is not against them yet, but running short. Right now, if Tanner Price could put together another drive as he just did, Demon Deacons could get back in this game for one time trailing 35-0. Price firing complete. Terrence Davis with the catch.
Tanner Price can throw the football, and I give him a lot of credit because in recent weeks when they moved to this gimmicky offense with different formations and options, he showed tremendous leadership, kind of accepted the coach's game plan, and went out and worked hard. But here they are playing catch up, and you're getting to see how accurate he can be.
Give to Campanaro. Camp didn't find much running room. It'll be second and 10.
And it's been pretty consistent. If he has time, there's open guys. I mean, there's plenty of plays to be made against Clemson secondary. It's just about if he's had enough time to throw the football.
I mean, he's efficient, guys. I mean, last year threw for over 1,000 yards, only threw six picks, or 3,000 yards, only threw six picks. Only him and Tyler Wilson are the only two quarterbacks in the country to play that efficiently. Throw for over 3,000 and throw six picks or less. I mean, he can do it.
In second and 10, corner blitz coming in. Ragland was out there, and Tanner got rid of it before Sherman really turned around. And Tanner showing a little bit of frustration. Ragland missed a little time with an abdominal strain. Campanaro's missed time with a broken hand, but now a third and 10 facing the Demon Deacons.
So I like what Brett Venables is deciding to do now. Dial up the pressure, bring a corner blitz from the short field, try and make Tanner Price get the football out of his hands quicker than he wants.
Clemson only rushing three this time. Out of time for Price, dumps it underneath. And Martin is going to be short of the first down. Now you've got about 2 yards to go, and Grove is going to go ahead and send the punt unit out. The defense has played well in the first half of the third quarter.
Yeah.
They can't.
I agree with it.
Yeah, I do too. You can't concede the game.
It's
right
a three-possession game. That's all it is.
Yeah.
You're a fumble away or a turnover away or a special teams play away from being right back in this thing. Go ahead and punt.
Totally agree. You can't concede the game. You give up a score there from 30 yards out. The hole's that much deeper. So now Humphreys with the fair catch at his 31-yard line. And the Demon Deacons will try to come up with a stop and get the ball back and see if they can draw a little closer to Dabo Swinney's team as he tries to fire up his offense. Now, this is what's left for Clemson and Florida State. Those two teams, along with North Carolina State, with only one loss in conference play on the Atlantic side. Now, Florida State might hold the tiebreaker over Clemson as Jesse circles the game we'll be at on Thursday night, November 8th. But North Carolina State has the edge over Florida State in the tiebreaker.
Yeah, you got to watch for that one. That could be the one I think Florida State slips on.
Josh Boyd keeping it, and he picks up close to nine on first down.
We talked earlier, guys, Clemson still has a lot to play for, whether or not they play in the ACC title game. We just saw the rest of their conference schedule. What about that home game against Steve Spurrier in South Carolina late? They win that game, they're 11-1. You got to be thinking a great chance for that large spot in the BCS bowl game.
They got some payback on their mind, too, when it comes to South Carolina. Dabo likes the shots that have been fired across the bow from Spurrier. It gives him back a little bit, too.
How many Death Valleys are there?
Yeah, and how many USCs are there? That's what Dabo answered with as Spurrier before they went down to LSU. And of course, LSU is called Death Valley. Clemson is as well.
Isn't that so much fun when we get coaches taking shots at each
other?
I
just love in-state rivalries. I love them. That last week of the season is my favorite by far.
Nice boy that's picking up the first down as the flip it out. He was trying to get it to Brandon Ford as a touchdown catch tonight. Zach Thompson was applying the pressure. Second and 10 coming.
You know, it's really important that Clemson is able to finish out this season. You know, last year they started 8-0. They were number 5 in the BCS, and they didn't handle the success so well. They only won 2 of their final 6 games, one of those, of course, being an ACC title game. But if they win tonight, they move to 7-1. They got to close the season out unlike what they did last year.
Trying to close this game out if they can. Boyd runs away. Whitlock has him, and Taj picked up 3. It'll be 3rd down and 7. And the one thing, though, the clock's going to continue to run here. Sometimes with the tempo that Clemson runs, you can't really bleed the clock down the way other offenses can. You give teams chances, at least.
And I also think that they're an offense that gets in a rhythm, and they're extremely hard to stop. That rhythm's been stopped. Now Taj Boyd's a little bit, you see how he's a little bit iffy in the pocket just then, took off and ran. They need to get something going to try to get this rhythm that they find. When they find the rhythm.
Boyd's been great on 3rd down with a whistle and a flag.
False start, number 2 of the offense. 5 yards, 3rd down.
You know, I think this is a bit of a concern. Sammy Watkins, by the way, back in the game now. So you wonder maybe if this coaching staff has decided, hey, let's get our best players back out there and close this thing out. But the inconsistency, so dominant in the first half, winning that 35-7. They've had issues now on offense and on defense here in the second half. Good teams put their foot down and keep it down when they get up on inferior competition. Clemson hasn't done that so far.
Boyd on 3rd down, and it's incomplete, and Wake Forest comes up with another stop. Kevin Johnson on the coverage against Hopkins.
Broken up now at number 9, Kevin Johnson, 4th down, Tigers.
1:17 remaining in the third quarter. Wake Forest is going to get it back. Spencer Benton to punt. Lavelle Jackson, the senior from Tampa, back to wait on it, and again, Benton gets it out of there just in time. Jackson with a fair catch at about the 24, and Sam Steele's down on the field.
Yeah, Reese, some unique circumstances here at Wake Forest. They have a student population under 5,000, and then a stadium that seats 30,000. So they rely heavily on the local community to show up. Now, tonight, the plan was to be a blackout. Didn't really turn out that way. Ended up being more like Halloween. The Clemson fans traveled incredibly well. It's only 3 hours from Clemson here, so a lot of fans drove up, including coaches, 2 of his sons made the trip. They're on the sideline down here trying to pump everybody up.
And Tanner Price getting away from Clemson's rush. Now Campanaro, they're going to give him the catch. He bobbled it slightly, and it looked like he was bobbling it. Maybe he secured it before he went out of bounds. They're giving him the catch at the 31.
I am amazed at Mike Campanaro's toughness tonight. This guy has a broken hand, all right? Yesterday was the first time he caught passes in practice. Here he is in the game. He's all suited up. He's making those kind of catches? Wow.
Harris slips a tackler. This is going to be a little bit short of the first down. Campanaro is a redshirt junior from Clarksville, Maryland. The hand injury against Duke on a reverse from Maryland ended up missing the Maryland game, but he's put up huge numbers. At the time of his injury, he was second in the country in receptions.
And they've been terrible all night in this little third and short situation. Hadn't been able to get it at all.
And pushing forward this time, they are going to get it. Good leg drive by Josh Harris. Harris, the leading rusher. He was a guy who last year, I don't know if you would say he got in Grove's doghouse, but he had trouble staying healthy, not quite as durable as Jim would have liked. So at the end of the season, Josh was hitting spot duty on special teams. He wasn't too happy about it. Contemplated for a while, perhaps not coming back. And he's come back, and Jim told us yesterday the thing he was most happy about with Harris, in addition to his production, was the fact that he's been able to stay durable this year. Price completes the pass and on the right side close to the sideline to Spencer Bishop. And with one tick left on the clock at the moment in the third quarter, Wake Forest trying to get a move, and we have a Demon Deacon down back on the 25. It is the left tackle, Stephen Chase, that we talked about earlier, who's playing already with a torn ACL, suffered on the second day of camp. He's just toughed it out all season for the Demon Deacons for an offensive line that was just decimated by injuries and defections.
This is a patchwork offensive line at best. They returned one starter heading into this season, and right before the year, they got struck with injuries. And we documented those earlier in the game. One of them was the Stephen Chase tearing his ACL in August. You know, a guy that they can't afford to lose, held off on the surgery because they were so thin. And as a result, guys, on this O-line, their left guard really right now is their backup center. And their right guard right now is a converted defensive lineman. And their right tackle really is a right guard. So that's what they're playing with right now. Now, if Stephen Chase can't keep going, Hunter Goodwin, a freshman, comes into play. A guy that just doesn't have the experience, and that just compounds problems that much more for this offense.
So what I got from that is it's not good.
It's not very good. No. Yeah. If you're Tanner Price, you're going to have to get the football.
Doing like an
court.
Operation game.
All right,
there,
the 1 second is off in the third quarter, so we're headed to the fourth quarter. Clemson up 35-13. As we start the fourth quarter, BB&T Field in Winston-Salem. That's Wake Forest left tackle Stephen Chase, just injured on the previous play. Jim Grobe talking to Steven as he comes off the field, and he really admires Chase's toughness. We've mentioned a few times tonight, Chase has been playing with a torn ACL all season long. Now he's out of there, and Wake Forest needing to convert, and they do. Josh Harris takes it into Clemson territory to start the fourth quarter. Coming in is a freshman, Dylan Intiman, number 63. He's a freshman from Wake Forest, North Carolina. He's a guy that Steve Lobotsky told us yesterday. They're high on him, talented, not really ready to play. Got no choice right now.
Yeah. And Jim Grobe, one thing he demands from his players is toughness. Whether or not they're outmatched on the field, he expects his guys to fight. He'll want that right now from his freshman Intiman.
Hunter Price. Harris out of the backfield. Harris nudged ahead to the 43-yard line. And let's see how Intiman did early on.
Lined up on the outside right here at left tackle. He's got the front side for a left-handed quarterback going against a speed rush specialist in Vic Beasley. Nice job there with the hands and the technique.
Nice job putting the tight end over there, too. Don't let that speed guy get out wide and start rushing that passer a little bit more.
There's no tight end help this time, and Beasley's getting down in a sprinter stance. Intiman stays in front of him. Price had to get rid of it. He was hit by Deshaun Williams.
Intiman wasn't the problem on that one.
See him line up again. A little stutter move there from Beasley. You see Beasley just kind of dip the shoulder and just try to just test that freshman outside.
He's a great athlete, but he doesn't know how to use his hands yet. He doesn't know how to turn the corner. Still figuring it out. I mean, he's obviously 225 pounds, too. He's not running right down the middle of anybody too often.
Third and seven. Price steps up, fires, and he missed. He and Sherman Ragland. Price and Sherman Ragland tonight have had trouble getting on the same page. It's at least the third time there's been an opportunity for a completion and they haven't been able to connect.
Fourth down, they're debating going for it here. I think they, now Tanner Price coming off the field. He wanted to go for it. But again, Jim Grobe conservative right now. There's some boos here in the crowd. Again, three possession game, a lot of time left. Your defense has been playing a lot better in the third quarter. You anticipate Clemson not having good field position to start this drive.
Gotta go for it.
I think you're tempting fate. Tannehill puts it up high. Humphreys calls for the fair catch. He makes it inside the 15. 13:46 remaining. Wake Forest needs another stop from its defense to have a chance. Krispy Kremes are delicious indeed. Greg Thomas, he's gonna eat the entire dozen. You know, there was a time in my life when I could put down a bunch of those, and Sammy Watkins can pick them up and put them down, and he gets Clemson a little better field position.
That is solid camera work right there.
Solid donut eating right there, too. Krispy Kreme, home here in Winston-Salem, celebrating its 75th anniversary. They make the Wake Forest donuts in black and gold on game day. Little tasty treats. Ron Brown with a short reception, pickup of two. It'll be second and eight.
You know, we just saw Sammy Watkins have another big play, and I think a lot of people wondered, because he hadn't yet had a breakout game, what was wrong with Sammy Watkins? Well, guys, when you're the third ever true freshman to be named a first-team All-American, and you break ACC records in your freshman year, you set a school record tonight, but, you know, people expect you to score a touchdown every time you touch the football. And tonight he's finally gotten opportunities downfield that he didn't have in the last couple weeks.
Andre Ellington. Ellington up across the 35. Be a yard or two short of the first down. The 200-yard night for Sammy Watkins, just as you mentioned, a school record. It is also just 2 yards short of Watkins' output receiving for the entire season coming into this game.
He was in the Heisman discussion going into his first ever offseason. That's how impactful he was a year ago, but he's been always the same Sammy Watkins. Just tonight he's had the chances.
Big third down for Wake Forest. Taj Boyd, he'll pick it up to the 40-yard line.
I don't know if I've ever seen a freshman come in and look the way he did last year at the receiving position. I mean, to run routes, I mean, he's a big dude, but to see him stick his foot in the ground and cut, and to see him after the catch, he's a guy that goes up and plucks it at his highest point, but he's also a guy that after the catch is nasty. So, I mean, he's a first-round draft pick lock if he can stay healthy. Just an unbelievable athlete.
DeAndre Hopkins made that last catch, and this is what happened with Sammy Watkins, suspended after an off-season arrest for the first two games against Auburn and Ball State, had pedestrian games against Furman and Florida State. He was sick, started getting sick the night before the Florida State game, and it cost him the game against BC. Now Boyd going up top to Hopkins, and Hopkins makes the catch, and Clemson is on the move, their best drive of the second half.
This proves how in tune Taj Boyd is tonight. Watch this back shoulder throw. He's trying to get the double move to DeAndre Hopkins, but it doesn't fool the cornerback. So instead of coming off his receiver, he goes, you know what? I got my best wide receiver right now, one-on-one outside. I'm gonna give him a chance to make this play. Perfect throw.
And that's what's frustrating, because even when you win, you lose. Even when you're in great position, you got the guy covered, you're on top of the route like you're supposed to, he still catches the
Trent
ball.
Dilfer used to always say when we played together in San Francisco, there's no defense for a perfect throw. And that's what that was right there.
He can't say that. Look at the defense he had. It wasn't legal. Come on.
And Boyd kept it on third down.
And here's the other scary part. We've talked about Sammy Watkins a lot. Guys, the best player on this football team all year has been DeAndre Hopkins.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he was a basketball player his first 2 years, spent his springs playing basketball. This offseason, decided to skip it and dedicate himself to getting in the weight room. So he's more physical this year, and it's shown up on the field.
Third down and one. Watkins. Watkins hits up the first down. Hit by a host of Demon Deacons. Riley Haynes was the first one there, but it'll be first and 10 for the Tigers as they try to apply the knockout punch.
And that makes it tough, too, because he is such a good guy after the catch, or even running with the football, I guess you'd say, because they move him in the backfield, they play him as running back, and he can play tailback, and it just puts a defense in a bind so much.
And Boyd walked away, and they snapped it right to Roderick McDowell, and tremendous heads-up defense by Wake Forest. Boyd sort of faking as if he were looking at Chad Morris, the offensive coordinator, in the direct snap.
He fooled me. I'm up here thinking there's a corner blitz coming from the bottom of the screen you see right here. And I think that's why Taj Boyd's looking over to the sidelines. Hey, what do we want to audible to? Nice job by the Demon Deacon defense, staying locked in.
Scott Bicos, the linebacker number 32, is the one that was pointing to it immediately. He was ready for it. Taj turns it loose, and it's knocked away. A fine play by Chibika Makoro, except perhaps a little contact there. See what the call is. He was looking for Jerron Brown.
Yeah, he was holding him, trying to get back to the football.
Taj Boyd looking for another back shoulder throw on that. Had his receiver on the wheel route, moving the pocket.
Pass interference, number 6 defense. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
So here's all the eye candy again. Play action fake. They're going to pull a lineman, get Taj Boyd outside. Jerron Brown trying to work back. That is pass interference.
He got away with one earlier. He was just like, hey,
he did.
Try to
try it again. It's a little bit more contact this time. First and goal. Ejection on Jim Grobe's face.
When they've thrown it down here, their success has been over the football.
Gives to DJ Howard. Down to the 5.
You know, it's not just you have fast receivers, but you have big physical guys too. And a guy like Martavis Bryant, that's 6'5", Jerron Brown, 6'3", your tight end Brandon Ford, 6'4". And Nuke Hopkins is strong this year. He muscles smaller DBs in this area of the field.
Yeah, his hands, it doesn't matter if he's getting mugged most of the time, he's going to come down with the football. Quarterbacks like that, it's nice to have a guy, you just throw it near him and catches.
Boyd running, he stopped short of the goal line. It'll be third and goal.
A lot of the best red zone offenses in the country have a running quarterback. Colin Klein at K-State, the belldozer Blake Bell at Oklahoma. We used to see Tim Tebow do this back in Florida. What a weapon to have a running quarterback in this area of the field.
You ever seen anyone as patient as Klein?
Nope.
Running for
unbelievable. That's his best trait. I mean, he's not a burner. But you see, he'll just sit there and go, hey, 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 pitter-patter. Stick it up in there. Over 30 rushing touchdowns the past couple of years.
Option pitch to Howard. DJ looking for the corner, and looks as if he got it.
And now Taj Boyd can come out of the game. If you're Clemson, it's locked in. You can sit him. So we talked about the depth they have at wide receiver. Well, Andre Ellington's not in the game right now, so just bring in DJ Howard here on the speed option. See if he gets in.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
That's a touchdown. Wow. A lot of depth. At the skill positions, Clemson, hard-pressed to find other offenses that have as much as they do.
A blocked extra point. Wake Forest will have an opportunity to return it if they could corral it. And it just somehow eluded Joey Ehrman. There is a flag down. It was Chibika Makoro who was called for pass interference.
That's
early
right.
In the drive, who got the block on the extra point.
He blocked it for a reason.
Offsides, number 6 on the defense. Half the distance to the goal, replay to try.
Hey, but I like that. My man's still trying to get off the rock and still trying to block kicks. How about that? Extra points, 90% of people just quit. Don't even worry about it. Man at the top of the screen, well, I mean.
He had a chance to stop too, but he was like, you know what?
Why not?
Whatever.
41-13.
I'm selling out. They're going to catch me.
You know what? Hey, they don't see me.
I'm a push.
Maybe they're tired. Yeah. Maybe they're tired of throwing the flag. The extra point is good, and it's 42-13. Taj Boyd's had a tremendous night in Clemson on its way to its 7th win.
ESPN College Football Primetime is served by Applebee's. Try the new Southwest Flavors 2 for $20 menu all season long. See you tomorrow. And in part by the Buick Verano. Unexpected luxury in a car this size.
Move your feet. Don't get beat. Close out. Low, slow, under control. Jeff Bezdelic, the Demon Deacon basketball coach, getting his team ready for the season. He has 7 freshmen on the roster. Does have his leading scorer, C.J. Harris, back. 13 and 18 a year ago. His college basketball practice is starting. Clemson right on schedule, 42-13. Tigers have ACC Coastal leading Duke next week. Tibby Camacoro had an adventurous drive last time with a couple of penalties on him.
Can you say that out loud again? Coastal, ACC leader, Duke?
I wanted to get it in. I'm going to get this in, too. EA Sports did a little simulation. Kansas State against Oregon. What if they had played as they were originally scheduled to do? You see David's guy, Optimus Klein, going in, but Kenyon Barner would answer. So Oregon gave you a little of this and a little of that. EA Sports simulation is the Anthony Thomas. We'll show you the results of that coming up in a moment and also explain why we did it. And Vic Beasley got right around the corner and sacks Tanner Price.
Well, remember, you got that new tackle in there, freshman class.
So here is the result of the simulated games between Kansas State and Oregon. Kansas State just moved past Oregon in the BCS. AccuScore says Oregon would win it by one. EA Sports, friends there simulating the game, saying it would be a 10-point Duck victory over the Wildcats. Now, one reason that's brought up is because of what I mentioned, that Kansas State has slipped past Oregon in the second release of the BCS standings. Price throws complete underneath to Martin for a short gain. The other reason is this. Originally, Kansas State and Oregon were scheduled to play in the regular season. They had a home-and-home deal. But in 2011, when Oregon was set to play LSU and Cowboy in the Cowboys Classic, Oregon asked to move the game. Kansas State said, I got a better idea. How about if we just don't play it at all? And Oregon agreed. Now, to be fair, and there's been some criticism this week of Kansas State because of that, but Kansas State did have Miami on the schedule. Campanaro takes a big hit and throw down the middle. Clemson's going to force it to 4th-and-14. And look, everybody understands that Miami's not Oregon. It's not the same thing. But pretty much every major school in the country sort of does the ABC schedule. Yeah. You play one team from a major conference, a big-name opponent. You play a B-level team, maybe somebody outside the AQ conferences, and then a guarantee game. Kansas State already had Miami. So I think it's kind of hard to get on the Wildcats, with the caveat that nobody's anxious to go to Eugene. I get that, but I think it's hard to get on about it.
I wish they would have played. Just from a fan's perspective.
Sure, absolutely.
Oh, that'd be so much fun to watch. I have a hard time picking who I think would win that game, actually.
Wake Forest.
I think the best coaching decision Bill Snyder made was taking that game off the schedule.
But, you know, Bill Snyder.
Coach of the year for that
the
decision.
The first time Bill Snyder built the program on playing games he was guaranteed to win in the non-conference. Different era at K-State. So the fans lost out on that opportunity. There's a playoff coming. Scheduling could change, guys. Well, yesterday at Wake Forest, the DirecTV mobile studio was around so that Jesse and David could get their mugs on TV off him. And TJ, the driver, he's been busy taking that thing to Louisville for Louisville and Cincinnati tomorrow night, and from there it'll go down to Tuscaloosa for Mississippi State and Alabama, Battle of Unbeatens. TV mobile studio all over the place. I imagine we will dispatch it to some outpost for the BCS Countdown show on Sunday night. This is going to be a big weekend for the release of the BCS standings. Four matchups involving teams ranked in the top 14 of the BCS. Be a little bit of moving and shaking potentially, and even if the top teams should avoid getting knocked off, then you're going to have some one-loss teams get eliminated from the conversation. So any way you slice it, an important weekend coming up in college football. Naj Boyd still in the game, throwing for Newt Hopkins. It's incomplete.
I'm really curious to watch Taj Boyd moving forward after this game. He's got to be better at game management. This time last year, he was a Heisman contender after they were 8-0. But then he became a turnover machine. Threw too many interceptions, took too many unnecessary sacks. Moving forward, the end of the stretch run, it'll be interesting to see how he takes care of the football.
If I'm Clemson moving forward, I'd have him on the sidelines right now in the fourth quarter is what I'd do.
Perhaps the sluggishness in the second half flying. Wake sending pressure. Ball is tipped by Daniel Mack. It'll be 3rd-and-10. Here is the difference in Taj Boyd through the first 8 games. As Jesse mentioned, the numbers off the charts. We talked about it earlier. I'm sure Taj, when he watches the replay, is not going to love us talking about his weight, but he gained some weight, not as effective, not as much attention to detail, and the numbers suffered.
He lost his focus in the second half of the season last year. He's got to stay mentally sharp during the stretch.
Well, get all those pats on the backs.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you start balling, you're nobody. Nobody knew who you were. You were a question mark coming into the year.
And he throws one out there, and Martavis Bryant, he can flat go get it. Another explosive play for Clemson. That's going to put Boyd over 400 yards passing after the pickup of 37.
One of the few times it has not been a perfect throw deep downfield, but Martavis Bryant, 6'5" in the long arms.
And this is why I believe Taj Boyd was in the game. Cole Stout is now coming to replace him. With that completion to Bryant, Taj Boyd just set a single game record for passing yards in a game, 428 yards tonight, breaking Charlie Whitehurst's record of 420. He tied his single game record, one held by Boyd and Cullen Harper with five touchdowns tonight.
Okay.
So a little icing on the cake, another record for
Boyd. Is there a coach assigned to that on the sidelines? Like, ooh, we're getting close to the 400 mark. Maybe we should keep him in there to break a record?
Well, clearly that's what they did. They took him out after the completion.
But what happens if two snaps ago he gets a corner blitz, gets hit in the side of the head, and they lose him?
Could happen.
I mean, you roll the dice, that's great, but let him get it under the right circumstances, I think. I mean, congratulations, that's awesome.
Now keep it on the ground. Roderick McDowell with a good pickup. Flags come in late. Different coaches have different philosophies, and there are guys sometimes who will say, hey, coach, you know, he's close to 400. He's close to this record or that.
Illegal block in the back. Number 83 offense. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Second down.
That penalty was called on the wide receiver, Daniel Rodriguez, and what a tremendous story Rodriguez is. He's a 24-year-old Army veteran who served in Iraq and Afghanistan. He is a Purple Heart and Bronze Star winner. He is attending Clemson on the GI Bill. Rodriguez led Clemson down the hill last week before they played against Virginia Tech. Continue the story after the second and 19 play. And Rodriguez has a catch. It's his second catch of the season. Rodriguez was involved in some of the heaviest fighting while he was in Iraq and Afghanistan. In one particular night, as you see what happened last week when he led Clemson down the field, he told a friend before they were involved in some heavy fighting, if I survive this fight, I'm going to go back home and pursue my dream of playing college football. His friend was killed very early in the fighting. Rodriguez was able to survive it. An inspirational story. He sent out videotape of him playing. He hadn't played football since high school. Dabo Swinney was captivated by Rodriguez's resolve and offered him a spot to be a walk-on. But Daniel Rodriguez, one of the heroes of our country, getting a chance to pursue a dream here by playing football for the Tigers. And it's a great story, and it's cool to see him out there.
That's a smart move by Dabo Swinney, allowing him to walk on the team, because that was a very young team heading into this year. The lessons that he can share in the locker room with respect to teamwork, leadership, accountability. I mean, there are so many benefits having him in your locker room. How he leads by example. You watch a guy like that, he's going to outwork everybody.
Dude, how many times I can't tell you how I went in the locker room, you hear the offensive line bickering about, oh, we got to do 25 periods today. Yeah, walk a mile in my boy's shoes right there.
Yeah.
Seeing people die, fighting for our country, a little bit different than putting some pads on and grinding in 2-a-days.
It's a great inspirational story. And Daniel says, you know, it did take a while to adjust. Some of the things you mentioned, David, you know, can be a little annoying when you've seen the things he's seen. You hear people getting upset. He said they can't log on to Facebook or, you know, whatever. And it's, but he's adapted and changed and enjoying his experience. And one of the perks on a much lighter note that Rodriguez gets as a Purple Heart and Bronze Star winner, there's a law in the state of South Carolina, as Clemson punts it away, that if you won the Purple Heart and Bronze Star, you can park anywhere you want to, regardless of any parking restrictions. So Dabo Swinney said everybody wants to ride with Daniel because
he can
park anywhere he wants to. Inspirational story for the Tigers reserve wide receiver. Clemson's up big in the fourth. I've got an idea for the next big fitness craze. Join us on Thursday nights and do push-ups with the mascots. The Oregon Duck, last week, we put up a bunch of points. Tonight, the Clemson Tiger having to do a push-up for every point scored. You do that, and I mean, you will be ripped, and lives will be changing across this nation of ours. 42 Clemson's put on the board tonight. Wake Forest fought back, couple of possessions, down just three touchdowns in the third quarter, but couldn't put together a scoring drive. Clemson was able to put it down, and making the tackle on that play for the Tigers was Adam Humphreys, who's playing wide receiver and has been working at cornerback because of the injuries the Tigers have had in the secondary. One of their starting cornerbacks, Rashad Breeland, has an abdominal injury. He didn't make the trip tonight. They lost Darius Robinson to a broken ankle against Virginia Tech. They only have one guy starting the same position in the secondary every game this season. That's their safety, Jonathan Meeks. And so now Humphreys, who played defensive back in high school as well, has been working a little bit at corner. Josh Harris on the reception. Harris knocked out of bounds by Robert Smith.
I think in the big picture moving forward, for this team to be a legit national championship contender, they got to get better on defense. And there's a perception out there after giving up 70 points in the Orange Bowl that they don't do that. And they won't change that perception until they start doing this consistently week in, week out. They've had their growing pains through the first half of the year under new defensive coordinator Brett Venables. But their last 2 weeks, they are getting better.
Third down coming for Clemson. And to clarify, national championship contender, you're talking big picture in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, moving forward, year in, year out, because Davey mentioned it earlier. The offense
next
is
year.
There.
Well, next year's a year for them. I mean, all the youth on defense get a lot of guys' experience, especially in the trenches. No juniors, no seniors. Get some guys up there. I'm talking about in the future. They're going to be very young. Get some experience, because if Hopkins returns, Watkins, Boyd, holy cow. I mean, you got to find a running back that's explosive, but you got the makings.
Third down and fourth, completion for the first down, and you guys want to see defensive players? Well, Dabo's got another one committed right now, the number one defensive end in the country. That is Robert Kimdiche, and he's an absolute terror on defense. Won a recruiting battle, and Robert's brother plays at Ole Miss, so the Rebels were hot and heavy after him. But
is Kimdiche, he a running back or a defensive
end? No, he's going to be a defensive end. That 90s is going to be what he wears when he gets in the orange and purple. Down the middle, Jackson makes the catch and takes a big hit. Wakes on the move inside the 40.
If he comes here, the defensive line can be a strength for them next year. They got four sophomores now that are playing a lot of football. You put Kimdiche with those guys, and all of a sudden that D-line becomes a strength again on this unit.
And he's a can't-miss prospect. Yeah. Talk about the number one guy in the country. This is like Clowney a couple years ago. He might not be as explosive as Clowney.
Throw out to Jackson's a little bit wide. And they also have, they've recruited very well on defense, a couple of young linebackers. Tony Stewart, who is coming back from two ACL injuries, had one his last year in high school, one halfway through the season last year at Clemson. He's coming into his own. Stephon Anthony's in there. He started some games this year. We've seen the freshman Travis Blanks, who may be a safety by trade, but he's played some linebacker as well. So Venables has some pieces to work with. Another completion, ball's on the ground. Terrence Davis turns around and covers it up. We wind down toward the minute and a half mark remaining. Friday night on ESPN, Cincinnati and Louisville battling for Big East supremacy, along with Rutgers. Cincinnati coming off a loss to Toledo, and Louisville's off to a terrific start.
Teddy Bridgewater, it's remarkable. I mean, two incompletions in week one against Kentucky. I think he had five against UNC, four this past week against South Florida. I mean, the ball doesn't touch the ground.
And Price throws it too hard, and that ball would not have touched the ground if Robert Smith could have held on to it.
I think moving forward, Clemson just has to eliminate the explosive plays they're giving up. Guys getting misaligned. You know, when you have an opportunity to get turnovers, you got to capitalize on them. You got to do a better job tackling in the open field. All things they got to work
on. Well, that's one of the complaints I would have. If I'm building the successful teams in the country, the really good ones build their defense to fit their offense. If I'm building this defense, I'm making you go the distance. I'm not playing a lot of man. I'm playing zone, dink and dunk. You know, I'm going to make you earn everything.
Beasley was after Tanner Price, and then after Beasley chased him for a while, Carlos Watkins, another freshman, was after him. Oh, incomplete, and Clemson will get off the field. It's Brent Venables coaching up Kariko Wright. He's one of the captains. ESPN College Football, available anytime, anywhere on your computer or mobile device. Watch ESPN.com, watch ESPN app. That's going to be a huge thing to make sure you have on Saturday, a significant Saturday in college football in terms of BCS standards. Big night for Sammy Watkins. According to the stats monitor in front of me, he has precisely doubled his output throughout the season. He had 202 yards receiving coming in. He has 202 tonight and a touchdown. Taj Boyd, a school record, 428 yards through the air. Both those guys having huge night. Now, Wrangler five-star player of the game is Taj Boyd, just eking out a victory over Sammy Watkins. Five touchdown passes, matching a school record. He's done it twice, and 428 yards.
It's the best time for him to have the game of his life. Critical juncture in the season. Remember, at this point last year is when it started going south for Taj Boyd. Can he handle success? Can he build on this momentum?
Well, the best time would have been against Florida State, really. But besides that, tonight was a good night.
He can't get that one back, though. The final's going to be 42-13. SportsCenter's just around the corner. Game two of the World Series. Bucks going for their first road win. And David Stern announcing his plans for retirement. Dabo Swinney and the Tigers, a 42-13 winner over Wake Forest. Time now to head to SportsCenter.